Live from New York City, this is the Artie Lang Show. Here's Artie.
Hey, welcome to the Artie Lang Show from what I assume is still the AshleyMadison.com studios in Lower Manhattan. Ashley Madison, a good friend of the show. We appreciate it. John Ritchie, my co-host. Mikey Boschetti, my announcer and my whole staff. Big announcement tonight, guys. Some people on Twitter figured this out by my cute little joking around on Monday. People on Twitter figure everything out, man. It's crazy. There's some really smart people there wasting their lives. I mean, it seems like they're wasting their lives. I'm just doing Twitter.
They're all wasting it.
That was an odd drop right there.
Yeah.
Anyway, tonight will be the last night that I will be doing the Artie Lang Show on DirecTV. Tonight is the last show. I got a call from my agent on Friday afternoon, and he told me that DirecTV didn't want to continue with the show. They were very amicable about it, very nice about it, very professional and generous. You know, we're 2 years and 7 months into a three-year deal, so we're just a few months till the end. It would have been good to end it, but, you know, you got to make business decisions. This is a business. I'm no rookie at this. I've been in situations like this before. And, you know, the studio they built is beautiful. It costs money, though. You know, and you got to make money back. Quite frankly, I always thought we were a tax write-off for the Dan Patrick Show. If you make too much money with something, you need something to, you know, launder the money through. And I thought the show was a money laundering operation, which I know something about as well. So I have had a bunch of fun here. It's been an odd run, but, you know, DirecTV was very, very good to me, unbelievably good to me, really generous. You know, look, I mean, the studio is unbelievable, like no other I've ever seen in my life. They were very good to me creatively. They let me basically do whatever I wanted to do. I mean, what executive is going to let you do Deerdorf Abbey, for crying out loud? And they were great to me, and I have no complaints. There's no hard feelings at all. I have a lot of other opportunities out there, thank God. And you'll probably see me down the road doing something else, if not sooner or later, but maybe sooner. A couple of exciting things going on in my career, and you'll be seeing a lot of me. That's unfortunate for some people, but that's just the case. I want to thank my hardcore fans, the fans that watch this show. I love you guys. I mean, you really are loyal fans, and I thank you so much, all my fans. I mean, you know, you're a good group of people, and you treat me well, and I thank you for watching the show. You know, this is about par for the course for me, timing wise. I'm about a two year intervals is how I do my life, and I was on Mad TV for 2 years. I made movies for 2 years. I was on the Norm Show for 2 years. The Stern Show was the only thing I was on longer. 8.5 years there is way long. That's a lifetime for me. And then this was 2 years and 7 months. Almost made it to the end. So that's I'm over my average. This has been a bunch of fun. Unfortunately, I heard that Greg Ferguson announced he's leaving his show, and that's going to override this news. He's going to get all the headlines, the scumbag. He couldn't wait it a day? That's terrible.
What a scumbag.
You never want to be on a plane with someone more famous. I was on the plane with Drew Carey once, and I said, if this plane goes down, I'm getting second banana headline. They're gonna give it to Drew Carey. So, you know, Greg Ferguson is on CBS. I'm sure he'll get more attention. But I'll take second place. I'm used to that, too. So I appreciate DirecTV. Again, I can't say enough about how good they were to me. And they're being very generous and very kind with the way this whole thing is ending. And again, the fans that watch the show are as loyal as you can get. It's on late. It's, you know, not the most conventional show. I'm not the most likable TV personality as far as looks are concerned. But you people watched and listened, and I really, really appreciate it. To the staff in here, you guys are amazing. You made the show look great, sound great. And everybody in here is a real pro. And thank you for everything you guys have done. I appreciate you being here every night and your hard work. John, you stepped in and did a great job, man, when we needed you. And I'm sure you got a great future, but it's been a pleasure working with you, John.
Thanks, man.
You're a good man.
I appreciate you giving me a chance to come in and do this.
No, listen, I mean, you know, you could thank DirecTV for that again, but I definitely was verbal in wanting you here after we, you know, met with a bunch of people, and you were amazing and a great, great partner. I appreciate it, buddy.
Well, it's been the best job I've ever had.
Oh, great. Well, that makes it sadder. But
I am sad.
No, I'm sure you're going to want to do a bunch of great stuff in television. And then Mike Boschetti, I'll miss you the most, Scarecrow.
Thank you, Art. I had so much
fun. All right, let's cut his mic. Let's cut
his mic. I like to babble, but it was
you do.
Great to
No, yes. Mike, let me tell you something, Mike. You're the funniest person I've ever met in my life. Naturally funny. And I hope whoever's listening out there, give this guy a job. Now, listen, like I say, there are some opportunities I can't talk about. There's a chance Mike and I might be together again. I love working with him on.
I love you too, Art, and this is a great, great thing with everybody here, John.
You're going to talk yourself out of a job.
Oh, sorry. I'll keep it quiet.
No, I if the opportunity ever arose again, and who knows? What's going to happen? Maybe you'll see me and Mike doing our clever banter again. But thank you, Mike, for everything.
I love you, Artie. Thank you, and everybody here as well.
I love
you guys
too,
are great man. Friends. I love everybody here. You guys are awesome.
Now, do you want to finally admit that you don't like the Twins?
I love the Twins. Me and Dan had a lot of fun battles here, but he's a great friend. I love him.
Well, Dan's been around a long time, right?
No. Dan is a brilliant man. He knows what he's doing, and he's gonna work forever in this as well.
Well, he has already.
No, but I mean, you know.
Dan has worked forever.
No, but Dan's going to get – I wish I had the power to have give Dan his own –
Well, you don't. You have the power to give him nothing.
You couldn't
give him you couldn't give him a stick of gum.
Not right now.
But you know, I hope that you know you're going to stop getting Iowa shirts from people. That's depressing. But keep losing weight, buddy.
I know. We both got to
keep
do
your
right
yeah
thing.
Yeah. Keep on this track. Later, we'll be weighing you.
Oh no.
Because in a not too awkward decision, after I make this announcement, we'll be doing a full 2.5 hour show. Well, I'm glad actually, because the Donald Sterling story is the funniest story in the history of sports. I'm glad I get a chance to comment on that. Again, the whole staff here is amazing, and I thank you all. Danny Filato, in particular, I have to say, has become a good friend of mine. You're a good man, Dan. And who knows? You might see me and Dan back together at some point doing something. But thank you, Dan, for your friendship.
It's been the best job of my life.
Oh, okay. Again, geez, I didn't know that. You could have told me that a month ago.
And I want to thank the audience, too, except for the kid that faked cancer in Dallas. I can't remember his name.
That kid was disgusting. But James, Shane, Josh. Well, you're Mike, right? I'm kidding. KC, there's Ola, who's basically a cast member. And then who's that, Manuel back there on the jib? We had a bunch of great jib guys. I wish I could say goodbye to all the jib guys. Thank all you guys for everything. It's been amazing. By name, the people at DirecTV who have continued to treat me nice, and Chris Long, Chris Crane, James Crittenden, and Ken Cole, in particular those guys, I want to thank for giving me a great ride here. This was a lot of fun. A lot of fun. And, you know, look, the perks of this job were amazing. I'm a Giant fan my whole life. I got to sit three rows off the field in Indianapolis to watch the Giants beat the Pats in one of the best Super Bowls ever. Third row. And I got to bring my cousin Jeff, who's like an older brother to me, for his 50th birthday. He's a huge Giant fan. Because of Chris Long and DirecTV, I got a chance to do that. Got a chance to see the only Super Bowl that might ever be played in New York City. I went to Media Day and made some noise. Me and Chris Culliver forever linked because of this show. I'm sure he's happy about that. But I've had a bunch of fun. There's been a bunch of great moments here. You know, and as I'm saying it, I'm even getting a little sentimental. It's been great. Again, to all the DirecTV people, thank you so much. These are great people to work with, and, you know, I would support this company if I were you, despite some of the commercials. I would support this company. The latest one with the puppet woman, I don't get quite right. DirecTV cannot be a more awesome company to work for. Or, I mean, listen, I have it now in a couple of my homes. That's right, I have two homes. And I'll have to sell one now, but I have to sell the elevator in the shore. The DirecTV is an awesome service, too. It's amazing. So thank you. I can't thank them enough. And again, the people here and the fans, especially, the fans are just amazing people. They are. They're so good to me, my fans. They're the reason I'm able to make a living in this world. I mean, look at me. I look at them. I'm a disgusting person, and I make a living in this business. I didn't even go to college. The twins back there, Marie and Liz, I want to say, you know, hopefully they'll come out at some point. You girls are sweet girls, and you'll have to go back to your trust funds, which I know is hard, back to one of your 15 mansions. But listen, I hope at this point, now that you know me, I can take a leak at your aunt's house. Before they got a chance to know me, of course, they wouldn't let me go to the bathroom at their aunt's house. But now maybe they will. We didn't know you. I mean, you look like a disgusting homeless person.
Oh, no, no.
I mean, big deal you gave us a job on a TV show. We can't let you up to go to the bathroom. I had to take a leak on the corner of 58th and Park that night, girl. Girls, thank you for your show. You've been
Artie.
Amazing on the show. You're sweet girls. You're beautiful. And I'm sure you'll go on to have great careers.
Thanks, Artie.
Thanks, okay?
Artie, for giving us the chance.
Oh, no, but listen, now you're kind of celebrities. You have to keep moving on. You know?
Right. Got to keep my fans.
You're beautiful. You pop. You pop on screen is what they
say. Oh, thank you.
I never had that. But you girls pop. And next, Mike, you really pop.
I know. He's the best guy to stand next to.
Yes. I mean, that's why I got him. Why do you think I got him here? Again, I've said this before. I picked Mike by Googling comedians fatter and uglier than Artie Lang. There was one person who showed up. I love that laugh when the second chin gets pronounced like a frog who's pregnant.
There's a chin and a half now.
Absolutely. You look great.
Thanks.
Doesn't he look good,
too.
Girls?
Yeah, you look really good, too.
Now, girls, do you want to admit that you don't like Mike? And
no.
You think, and you'll never talk to him again.
I'll do that in, like, maybe 5 years. 5 years? Yeah. Wow.
No, come on. You got to do it. Mike is really upset by that. You can tell. He doesn't know what to say. He's blushing.
But why would you do that in 5 years?
Because it would be more established then.
That would be so hurtful, just 5 years after today.
Yeah, better now.
No, but these girls...
What are the chances me and Mike are going to be around in 5 years?
Oh. No, don't say that.
Mike, do you think, how long do you, are you going to think, you think you live till 100, right?
Well, we may be roommates one day. You never know. I hope so. It'll be awesome being old men in the same room like 85 years old.
All right, I'm going to drive into the Hudson River. Now, that is my greatest fear, that Mike calls me one day and goes, Artie, you know, we've become friends and I have nowhere to stay. That's why I got to keep the bigger house.
We'll
you could have your own wing.
But we'll live in Sunset in the old actor's home.
You'd be like Quasimodo in your own wing, like ringing the bell. Send food up to him. Disgusting butler with an acne problem.
Mm-hmm.
I'd feed you good, though, Mike.
Oh, no. Tell I know
the
you
entire reason I have an elevator down the shore is so sausage and peppers can come up to the third floor. But, of course, I can't eat them anymore.
No more, no.
I'm on a strict diet of dust and salad.
I'm on the same astronaut food diet.
I know it's terrible, but you got to do what you got to do. So that's it. That's the announcement, guys. There's a couple of phone callers here. Jimmy in Boston. Let's go to Jimmy in Boston.
Artie, God Almighty, I just spoke with you Friday.
I know.
You told me to call back Tuesday.
Well, that was
that meant.
It was a cute little joke I was making. There's no show tomorrow. Maybe there is. I don't know. You might be talking to Michael Costa tomorrow or Jay Bourne.
Artie, you're going to land on your feet. There's one thing I know about you. You always land on your feet when you do it. And I know you're going to do very, very good. And, you know, I mean,
I miss you.
My wife, that's Marie.
Oh, that's very sweet. Thank you, Marie. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, you know, listen, as a matter of fact, I mean, you know, I'm not going anywhere soon. I'm taping a special for Comedy Central on June 21st. It airs in September. And as a matter of fact, I might as well get a plug out of the way. This Saturday night at 11:45 p.m., I'm doing Gotham Comedy Club. I wear this as a badge of honor. Comedy Central's lawyers want to tape my hour before and give me notes before I tape it. So I'm running the hour, as we say in the comedy business, this Saturday night, 11:45, the late show at Gotham. So if you want to come and see what the special's basically going to be and watch Comedy Central tape me, come to Gotham. Tickets available now. I'm just announcing this. I'll put it on Twitter. But this Saturday night, 11:45. And my special is going to air in September. And the paperback version of Crash and Burn comes out June 3rd. I'll be all over the place for that. Tonight show, everything. So you're not going to get rid of me that quickly. But, Jimmy, I appreciate the call. Marie, that was so sweet of you.
Yeah, listen, Artie, we're going to see in Hampton Beach, by the way.
Oh, good, okay.
We're going to, you know, I told you, we got gold seats, we're sitting third row.
Oh, awesome.
You know, so I'm hoping we're going to get a chance to meet you. Marie's going to send a picture of us, you know, to tweet a picture of you.
Great.
Of us together.
Great, thanks, guys. I'll look forward to it. I love playing that place, the Hampton Beach Casino. I'll see you up there.
Artie, just make sure you get yourself another deal on another format and another platform. A lot of people who watch this show that will pick this up. And, there's nothing like your show, you know?
Take care of yourself.
Thanks, Marie.
She wants you to take care of yourself.
I will. I promise.
I spoke to you how I felt about the other night. I'm devastated. This is like, I can't believe the show is canceled. I'm just like, I don't know.
I'll be around, brother. I'll be around.
All right, brother. We love you.
Thanks, Jimmy. Marie, I'll see you guys in New Hampshire.
We'll see you in Hampton.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for supporting the show. Mike in Milwaukee. Mikey.
You hear this?
Yeah.
That's not aspirin. I'm turning to the rattler here.
Is that the rattler?
What is going on, dude? Jeez Louise. Can I swear today?
No.
I'm losing it over here.
No, you can't swear here. Put it this way. The place I might be soon, you could swear. That's the hint I'll give you. But, okay. Mike, I appreciate your loyalty. I do. You've been the best fan of the show.
We absolutely love you guys, all of you. All the ball busting with Danny is just that. Listen, even my dogs are upset now. So I got to get a clarification here. Are you not going to be here Saturday?
No. The Milwaukee and the Milwaukee show and the Minneapolis show have been postponed. I had to do that for medical reasons. My doctor asked me to do that. But those will both be rescheduled. And then I'm back on track. At the end of May, I'll be back, on my full tour. That's up on
the website. That sounds good. You know, I can't thank you enough for all the years of, especially these last few where we've been able to connect a little more personally, all the entertainment. It's just been, it's like having a friend, on the radio and on TV every night that you can check in with and yuck it up and have a good time. And you guys are all just absolutely the best. We absolutely love you.
Thanks, Mike. I love you, too, and I look forward to seeing you down the road. You and the Hammer.
All right, buddy. Take care and be well. And
all right.
Please stay in touch.
You got it, Mikey.
All right. Love you.
Real quick, Ed in Palo Alto. I got to go to a break. Eddie, what's up, brother?
Hey, Artie. How you doing, man?
What's up?
Hey, I just let you know, man, I've been a fan since you and Nick started it, and now that you got John on there, it's even gotten better. It's just an awesome show, and it's just sad to see you're going, man.
Listen, it's show business, brother. I appreciate the kind words, but, DirecTV will have a bunch of good stuff for you down the road, and I'll be around, too. I mean, I can't do anything else to make a living, so I'm going to stay in show business, kind of.
Yeah, that's understandable. But, yeah, I just, I've been fighting with SiriusXM for the last couple of, since the Olympics, actually, because after the Olympics ended, they never put you back on. And I've been fighting with them, and finally I told them last week, this is false advertisement. Put the Artie Lang show on or I'm going to sue. Last week they put it back on, and now you're going. What's up with that, man?
I wish I could tell you, brother, but I got to say, the DirecTV people have been very nice, and you have to make business decisions. That's what goes on. But I gotta go to a break, Ed. Thank you so much for calling, man.
Thanks, Ed.
Thank you. You and John and the whole cast, just have a great one, and I hope to hear you guys out there again somewhere else, man.
All right. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you.
Ed, real quick, Mike, who's on the show, brother?
Okay,
the last show. Who's on the last show?
Tonight, George in studio, theater and television.
Tonight, shoot, last one of those.
Okay, one more, buddy. Tonight, George in studio, theater and television actress Crystal Joy Brown.
Nice.
Stop by in the second hour. Great friend of the show. I love this man. I hope we stay in touch and hope he gets me some chicks. The great basketball analyst, Al Elnavi.
Yes, both were on that. I'm so glad Al is here, our friend. Go ahead.
Al Abdonabi.
That's perfect.
And great friend of the show, hanging out in third hour, comedian, TV personality, Chris DeStefano.
Wow. You do not disappoint. I'm glad the last guest ever is my good friend, Chris DeStefano. And a surprise guest, my good friend Donald Sterling will be here live. We got to talk about that. The tape's the funniest tape ever. It's just two gross people talking, him and that broad. It's two disgusting people having a conversation. They should release that as a comedy album. All right, 888-936-8822, 888-936-8822. Is the number if you want to be part of the last show. And when we come back, the perfect thing to do after this announcement, I'll interview an actress on Broadway. The Artie Lang. Are you looking for an easy way to spoil your dog while helping a good cause? BarkBox.com serves dog parents, people who are obsessed with spoiling their pups and giving them the very best. BarkBox helps dog parents make their best friend happy by discovering the best toys, gadgets, treats, and products that the special pup in your life will love. BarkBox delivers a curated package of 4 to 6 items straight to your door once per month, and they donate 10% to rescue centers and shelters across the U.S. BarkBox is the perfect gift for the crazy dog parents in your life. And each purchase will contribute to efforts to save the 7 million animals who enter shelters each year. Go online today and get BarkBox for as little as $17 per month. All edibles are made in the U.S. or Canada, and shipping is free to the lower 48 states. Visit BarkBox.com/Artie, A-R-T-I-E, and get 20% off your first order. Again, that's BarkBox.com/Artie. Welcome back to the Artie Lang Show. My first guest is unbelievably talented. You know she is just from the job she has. She's got a tough job. It's a lot of work, but I've heard it's amazing. She's a star of the Motown show on Broadway right now. She plays Diana Ross, which means she's pretty good. Crystal Joy Brown. What's up, Crystal?
You know, I'm happy to be here. I'm so sad that this is your last show, but I'm honored to be part of the last
show. Well, yeah, you're part of the last show. This is history in the making. You're like,
absolutely.
You know what? Bette Midler was on the last Tonight Show with Johnny. You're like my Bette Midler.
Right. Oh, my God.
Would you like to sing something for him?
I would. I actually would.
Okay, whenever you want to. We'll see if we got. Well, give us time to get the rights to it.
Yeah. Okay. Perfect. Yeah,
right. No, but listen, so, Diana Ross, first of all, that's a lot of responsibility for an actress, because you talk about one of the really important historical figures. People don't talk about her enough and the Supremes and what they did and how enormously popular they were. I was just telling Danny before the show, I saw the documentary on HBO about the first Ali-Frazier fight, Muhammad Ali. Mm-hmm. And I had never heard this before. The promoter told the story where after the fight, he went in, Ali lost. And he goes in and there was a woman crying at Ali's feet. And he didn't know who she was, and Ali said to the woman, "Hey, Diana, say hi to the guy who paid me $5 million to get my ass kicked." And it was Diana Ross. You know, I mean, like, you know, you talk about Diana Ross and Muhammad Ali.
Wow.
I mean, you know, you just think of how these two iconic figures. You're blown away by both of them. What was it like when you found out you're playing Diana Ross?
I mean, first of all, the audition process was insane because you have Berry Gordy sitting there.
That's crazy.
You know,
Berry Gordy, that's the creator and starter of Motown.
Yeah. It's he wrote the show.
Right.
So it's also his kind of his idea of how he kind of created Motown, and it's kind of a flashback. It's a dream or a, not really a dream, but it's kind of like a detailed, heartfelt way of how he created Motown and created the first black megastars ever. I mean, the Jackson 5, Diana Ross,
Temptations,
the Contours, Rick James, the Commodores, Tina Marie. You'd forget how much of an impact this record label had on history and definitely on the music industry. And you can tell, this is the first show I've ever done where I walk into the theater and I look out into the audience and it's like, black, white, Asian, everything. It's so diverse.
Everybody loves Motown.
It's just so diverse. And I just think
Donald Sterling loves it. He was in the front
row. I'm sure he does.
Just don't bring black people to the theater.
Yeah. Jesus. Okay. Yeah, I listened to that. I did.
It's gross.
It was amazingly horrifying.
Yeah, he has a nasally voice, too, which makes it even more annoying. I don't kid you. I give them clothes.
But, like, his girlfriend's black and something else. Right. Like, I don't get it.
It doesn't make any sense.
I just don't get it.
Do I give them houses and clothes? Does somebody else do that?
I feed them. I graze them.
I feed them. Yeah. I give them sneakers.
I can't.
Yeah. So now, how long have you been doing the show?
I've just started at the end of January. January 24th was my first show.
Right. And so it's been a while already.
Yeah.
Three months of it's got to be crazy.
3 months, equals like 120 shows or 100 and something shows. So it goes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. So
you do 8 shows a week. So you just.
And like
don't
two
stop.
On Sunday or two on Wednesday?
Two on Wednesday and two on Saturday. But we're going to switch our schedule. So we'll have two on Saturday and two on Sunday. And then we die on Monday.
Just so Monday you're dark.
Yes.
So now your day off. I always wanted to ask somebody with that kind of Broadway schedule. How much do you cherish Monday?
Monday is typically my day to recover from my hangover.
Yeah.
So I am in bed until about 1.
Well, NFL guys, John in the NFL is similar, but Mondays were probably just like you just.
Yeah.
No, what do you feel
Monday
like?
Monday we had to go in and lift and run.
Wow.
Yeah, try to flush lactic acid out and get treatment for our various injuries.
Tuesday
we had off. Yeah.
But
Tuesday
honestly,
you wouldn't move.
That would be great.
Yeah.
Well, it really is a work ethic. Not only do you have to be talented, I mean, you got to have a work ethic.
Well, and also it's, you do a Broadway show, but then you also do other things around it. You do readings for news shows, you do TV shows, you diversify as much as you possibly can, so you don't really have a lot of downtime.
Right.
How does your workload now compare to, like, Hair or Rent?
Hair was a very interesting show to do because you're on stage for the entire time. The entire ensemble is on stage for the entire show. So it's like 2 hours and 15
Did you get
minutes.
Naked in Hair?
Of course I did.
How'd I miss that? You're probably fully clothed in Motown. When are you going to do Hair again? Can you do one
do
more show of Hair?
I do wear a bathing suit in Motown. I don't know.
Oh, well, that's good enough.
Yeah.
But it's not like, you know.
Right.
Can you do one more Hair?
But it's, you know what? Like, I watched Hair, and it was really disorienting when you see 26 naked bodies. Like,
it's odd.
You're really like looking at boobs and every, like, you're like, what? Trying to get all of it. And it's really quick.
Yeah.
So you have to come and, you had to come and see it a few times if you were good. But sometimes we'd be like, freedom!
Right.
And then it would be like, flash. Someone has taken a picture. They knew exactly when the nude
was coming. Exactly. You're all over the internet immediately.
So, yeah. So it'd be like,
Now, hypothetically, when
just
I get home,
turn the lights off.
Hypothetically, when I get home tonight and I'm by myself, if I Googled Crystal Joy Brown, it'd probably be some footage of you naked.
I don't think so.
A couple of still pictures, maybe.
I don't know. So,
why in a bathing suit in Motown? What does
because
that say?
Because we go to the Bahamas.
Oh, you do? Of course.
Yes.
What, am I crazy?
I mean. Yeah.
Why do you go to the Bahamas?
We go to Paris. We go to the Bahamas.
I see.
We do lots of things. I mean, black people falling in love in Paris. Has that ever happened? Like, at what movie have you ever seen black people fall in love in Paris?
Well, now after Kanye and Jay-Z had that song, I'm sure there's a lot of black people going to Paris.
Well, maybe now. Now.
Yeah, well.
2014.
Well, listen, Paris was always friendly. They were always more enlightened than people. Charlie Parker, all the jazz guys.
Well,
Josephine
Baker.
They were beloved there.
Yeah,
you know?
That's true. And I mean, it was a place to go for in the 1920s for black artists.
Now, what songs do you sing? I got to tell you, I'm a guy's guy, I'd like to think, but the Supremes just make me melt, man. Someday, or even that song, I've been crying.
Oh, my God, that was a good face.
Because I'm lonely. No, I got the, for you.
Ooh.
Smiles have all turned to tears. I always feel bad for the two in the back.
Yeah.
So now one of them is dead. Are both dead in the back?
No.
One's dead.
Mary's still alive.
Mary's still alive. She was hot, Mary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, they all were, like, sexy in their own way.
Yeah.
They all had, like, a sex appeal in their own way. And, like, Flo was, like, you know, just kind of, I don't want to say... She was just the wild card.
Now, didn't Diana Ross have a child with Berry Gordy? Didn't
she
that come
did.
Out? Now, is that covered in the play?
No.
He glossed right over that, right?
Well, there's certain things that you just kind of can't. There's so many years of history.
Right.
And their relationship was so amazingly complicated, but so fueled with this crazy intense love.
Yeah.
And his love for her and, like, you know, her motto was, if you think it, I can do it.
The guy,
she would say
I mean,
that to him.
Now, you're talking about two geniuses getting together. Now, what songs do you sing in the play?
Where Did Our Love Go?
Oh, wow.
Stop in the Name of Love, of
That's
course.
Amazing. Yeah.
I Hear a Symphony.
Oh, I hear a symphony.
Yes.
I love
some words
that.
Right there.
No, that's a great... That goes right through you. It's good. I got to see the show.
You
I
do.
See,
it's really great. I mean, and then... We have all these other acts. I mean, we have Jackie Wilson. We have Smokey Robinson. We have many.
Was Marvin Gaye a Motown guy,
yeah,
too, right?
Yeah, Marvin Gaye. And he's...
Now, do they have the scene where his father shoots him in the head?
No.
They're going over all the
controversy. It's a family show.
Well, I'm going to go. We got to take a break. I couldn't imagine a more entertaining thing. I got to check this out. Crystal Joy Brown is here, and we'll talk more when we get back. The Artie Lang Show.
Mm-hmm.
listen to Artie and the crew anywhere with the all-new Artie Lang Show mobile app. Download it today.
Welcome back to the Artie Lang Show. Talking with Crystal Joy Brown, star of Motown. She plays Diana Ross on Broadway, which is, as I've been saying, pressure. I mean, I'm 46 years old, so I'm even a little young when Motown really hit. But my parents and aunts and uncles and older, you know, people that I knew all listened to it when I was growing up. And like Marvin Gaye was one of my favorites. So I mean, you're younger. I mean, did you grow up with an appreciation of Motown?
Oh yeah. I mean, we had the Christmas album since I was a kid.
Right.
And we just always listened to it. It's just something that you always had around. You always listened to Marvin Gaye. I mean, yeah. I grew up listening to all of that.
Have you ever been to Detroit?
I have not yet.
I've been there plenty. Well, I was just in the hospital there for 9 days. That was wonderful. But, I've done stand-up there a bunch of times. And yeah. I drove by the Hitsville. It's one of the coolest American sort of tourist things to do. It's really cool to see that building.
Yeah, well, now it's a museum. So you can go in and tour. It's a historical monument, you know. Just what Motown did, it really allowed, white people all over the country to kind of start listening to soul music,
right?
Which, it just became pop music.
Right.
And
okay.
It's like the Supremes went on tour with the Beatles. Yeah. So,
Think about that show, first of all. I saw Vixen open up for Eddie Money once. I enjoyed it. I couldn't imagine. The Supremes at Montclair State College. Now, do you cover Diana Ross discovering the Jackson 5? Because that's the legend, that she discovered them and brought them to Barry Gordy.
Well, that's what people say, that she...
That's the legend,
Suzanne
right.
DePass actually, supposedly, was the one that really discovered Jackson 5. So they kind of, they tell that story. But she presents them. And because she presented them, she kind of got the credit. But when they moved from Detroit in Indiana to Hollywood, to L.A., they stayed in her house.
Right.
So she housed them. She took care of them.
It was a big family, Motown. It really was.
Yeah. But also, competition breeds champions, and that's one of Barry Gordy's
controversy. Well, did somebody play Michael Jackson in the show?
There's a young Michael Jackson.
How young?
There's two of them.
As a kid?
Yeah. They're, 11 and 13?
He was like 11 years old, yeah.
Yeah. And they're incredible. And
how do you find that kid?
Found this kid in L.A.
Right.
They found them somewhere in the South. They're all over now because now we have a tour.
Yeah.
So now we need like six of them. And I'm just astonished at how amazing these kids are. And they sound just like him. They move just like him.
It's amazing.
It is.
And I hear this, the same about you with Diana. Yeah.
Right. Do they work every night? I mean, aren't there like child labor laws or something?
There are child labor laws. Yes, but they switch
Barry Gordy has never acknowledged them. Get out there!
Does he circumvent them? No.
No, they're treated super well.
Let's hear ABC one more time. Daddy needs a new car.
They're out there working.
I saw Tito on a documentary about Michael Jackson talking about their schedule. their friend, their father, they would go from Gary, Indiana. They'd go to school all day. He'd take them in a van to Chicago. They'd do like four shows till 2 a.m, drive them back, do their homework in the van on the way back, and then go to school the next day and then come home, rehearse every day. I've seen, because I've traveled so much, I passed by the house that the Jacksons lived in Gary, Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
It is the size of this desk. The fact that they learned those routines in that house is the most astonishing thing I've ever seen. One bathroom, how do you learn those routines?
It was like all the same room, right? Yeah. They were all in one room.
I mean, that's the most fascinating thing about the story is they learned it in that house.
But that's the thing that he did. He took people that were completely below the means of becoming megastars and polished them and created these.
Right.
Like really well-oiled machine.
Just a marketing genius, basically. Yeah. Barry Gordy. Finding the right songwriters for the voices of these people and everything. And now, how many songs total do you sing in the show?
I sing about 15.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
And you sing the whole thing through, or are they medleys type thing?
They're kind of medleys. Some are like snippets, and some are full songs.
Right. I got to say, there's probably a lot of Broadway purists who don't like the way Broadway went. They want to see Streetcar Named Desire. But I got to say, I love it because it appeals to me now, shows like this. Because I love, Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons. I grew up listening to Motown. I grew up listening to, I've seen the Jersey Boys like three times. I'm dying to see this now. It wasn't even on my radar. I'm just dying to see it now. And I want to see it with you doing it.
And
I want to see Hair with you.
Well, when you come, I'm going to pull you up on stage and make you sing.
Oh, yeah, that'll be good. The audience will love that.
No.
Whenever you're near, I hear a symphony.
No, you're going to sing Reach Out and Touch.
Okay. I got to learn that one.
It's easy. Mm-hmm. You want to sing it with
How does that go? Go ahead.
It goes, reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place. If you can. Come on, let's raise our hands.
We're already over our budget.
Come on. Reach out and touch somebody's hand. Make this world a better place. If you can. That was beautiful.
What a great. So you were my Bette Midler. You were my Bette Midler.
That's all you have to do. And now I'm going to pull you up and you'll have your Broadway debut.
That'll be cut out of the radio. Again, we don't have the budget.
Barry Gordy Wilson.
Now, think of the money Barry Gordy must have. Do you ever sit down and think of that and make you hate him?
You mean, like, Google it?
Does it make you hate him?
Like, did I Google it?
Do you ever look at your paycheck and go, he could afford more than this? Think about the songs he has, the rights to. My God.
It's insane.
Heard it through the grapevine, it was $100 million alone. I heard it through the grapevine, it's $20 million. That, gone. That,
yeah.
Stop in the name of love, another 20.
Yeah.
The guy's worth $1 billion.
Yeah.
He should buy out Donald Sterling. Barry Gordy should own the Clippers tomorrow.
Well, then they might be a better team.
Right.
Ooh.
People might want to play for him.
It is a legendary thing to be a part of. And it's so cool that you're doing it. You know, it's have your parents come to see the show?
Yeah.
They must be so proud.
Actually, my mom's fiance died the day before I started of lung cancer.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
So then she came like a week later and... But it was just like, I just knew that he was there.
Were you close to him then?
Very close.
I'm sorry to hear that. Well, yeah, well, you listen, sometimes stuff like that can heal you.
Yeah.
You know? Music. It really
And it motivated me to want to do a great show.
Yeah.
And because he was a performer as well, so he kind of inspired me.
It is music that that gets you emotional and can help you in a time like that. I want to take another break, and when we come back, we'll finish up with Crystal Joy Brown from Motown on Broadway.
You've given me a true love, and every day I thank you, love, for a feeling that's so new, so inviting, so exciting, whenever you're
I was recently looking to buy a car and thought to myself, there has to be a better way. It's such a stressful process. That's when my friend told me about a new way to buy a car. It's called TrueCar.com. So my friend told me that at TrueCar.com, you can actually see what others paid for the car you're looking for in your area. The site gives you total transparency and the confidence to know when you're getting a great price. Because at TrueCar.com, you get a savings certificate, and you just take your savings certificate to a TrueCar certified dealer so you don't need to worry about the hassle and anxiety of the old way to buy a car. And TrueCar users save an average of $3,000 off MSRP. So seriously, if you're ready to buy a car, why wouldn't you go to TrueCar.com? Negotiation-free, guaranteed savings, a hassle-free experience, a TrueCar certified dealer that is committed to a new and better way to buy a car. Save time, save money, and never overpay. Visit TrueCar.com today. Welcome back to the Artie Lang Show. Crystal Joy Brown, who on my last show was the first person that has got me to sing. So,
yeah.
Pretty impressive.
It was an epic moment.
She's my Bette Midler, me and John Mitchell. Yeah. You got a fullback and a comedian to sing.
I'm so honored.
Crystal Joy Brown from Motown plays Diana Ross. I think that says something about her. Now, how old were you when you started singing? Were you a child, sort
of? Yeah, I was really young.
Actress? Did you do stuff as a kid?
Yeah, I was doing like the Children of the Gospel Choir in Washington, D.C. when I was 7.
Did you start in church?
Yes. Well, right. I went to an Episcopal church, so the singing wasn't great.
Was that a racist question? Kind of like, you must have started in a church.
Yes, obviously. Gospel? You sing gospel?
I mean, they start in churches, these people. Do I not pay for their churches? Who else pays for the church? I do.
Well...
Now, you started in a choir at 7.
Yeah.
So you could sing at 7.
Yeah, I was
which
singing.
Is odd because it's no guarantee you can sing as an adult if you could sing at 7.
That's true.
Right.
And definitely my voice has changed, and I think it will continue to change. It just does.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was helpful to be in choir. But then I went into opera, and then I started a punk band. And then
you did?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool.
And then what it
was
turned
the
into...
What was the name of the punk band? Can you say? A good punk band's name you can't say, actually. But...
Mm-hmm.
It's like, but not.
Okay. That might have made it out of here. I don't know. It made it to DirecTV.
Yeah, that's a band. Yeah.
That is a band, though.
That's a band.
Yeah, it is. Yes, yeah. It's a legitimate band.
It's in that league
they're all
of names.
Arrested, but yeah. They're, yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, the best punk name was in the very beginning, the Sex Pistols. You can't beat that.
Right. By the way, I just met Johnny Rotten like 3 weeks ago.
Are you a fan of his like I am?
I am such a fan, especially after meeting him.
Right.
And the selfies that we did.
Yeah.
He is insane.
Right.
I mean, he's a character.
They were a good band. Yeah. They were the
great band. Yeah. One of my favorites. I
right.
mean, but like I started off a little different. I liked a lot. I like a lot of rock. My first show I ever saw was Limp Bizkit.
Wait, and, talk about a band that went they got old quick. Yeah, like that guy was the biggest thing in the world and a
huge.
Joke. He became a joke like in 24 hours.
Yeah.
Fred Durst. It's weird.
Rage Against Machine.
Camarello, I love, yeah.
I mean, yeah.
You're in a band now, too, right?
Yes, I have a band. We're fairly new, but it's like a kind of a folk band.
A folk? You went from punk to folk?
Is it at least folk rock
or something?
I have lots
of things going on. Like, I write dance music.
We're talking about covering the genres. Motown, folk, and folk and punk?
I know. Yeah. I am confused, is really what's happening.
Well, you know what your problem is? You're talented at too many things.
That's
God
true.
Gave me one talent. You're looking at.
You're
that's
right.
It. I don't have to choose anything.
You talk.
You got to focus.
You talk funny.
I'm a BS.
Yeah. You're good at it.
I'm a con artist. But so you've decided, can you decide what you want to do for a long time?
I'm like you. I like to change things up.
Well, good.
And I'll constantly try to change things up as much as I can.
Well, I hope you keep doing that. You're great at stuff. I appreciate you coming here.
I'm so happy to be here.
And I'm excited
to see what's next for all of you.
Yeah, well, thanks for getting us to sing. Crystal Joy Brown, see her in Motown at the L'Enfantin Theater on 46th Street in the heart of everything. And I can't thank you enough for being a part of this. Okay. Crystal Joy, thank you so much. Back
thank
after
you.
This with the great Ala Abdelnaby and some phone calls. A lot of people call. You never want to be on a plane with someone more famous. I was on the plane with Drew Carey once, and I said, if this plane goes down, I'm getting second banana headline. Tire Rack is always thinking about tires, so you don't have to. Tire Rack is America's largest independent tire tester and consumer direct source for tires, wheels, and performance accessories. All Tire Rack team members are test drivers having hands-on experience. That's right. Their sales team of over 100 members are all test drivers, and their unbiased test results come from experience on Tire Rack's own test track. Tire Rack has also collected consumer reviews based on over 2.7 billion miles of drivers like you. When it comes to tires, they've got you covered from every angle you can think of, and probably a lot you haven't thought of, too. They have informative videos at TireRack.com covering a wide range of tire topics. Their one-on-one coaching offers customer support to help you find the right tire for your vehicle and driving style. Tire Rack also has a huge inventory of all major manufacturers at competitive prices. If you're looking for tires, there's no better place to go than TireRack.com. With over 35 years serving drivers' needs, they are the tire experts. Check them out at TireRack.com. That's TireRack.com.
Live from New York City, this is the Artie Lang Show. Here's Artie.
Welcome back. You're witnessing history. The last Artie Lang Show on DirecTV. My next guest is, I'm so glad he's here on this night. He's become a friend, and he's a great guest on the show. Talk some hoops, talk some Sterling, everybody's talking about that. We haven't had a chance yet. But Ala Abdelnaby's here. What's up, buddy?
Artie, good to be with you, John.
Yeah.
Walked in. Shane Elrod was kind enough to tell me the news. It was like a punch in the gut, man. So I'm really, really grateful to be here.
No, play. Listen, man, I appreciate you. You've been great on the show.
Because if I wasn't here and found out otherwise, I would be really, really crushed. So I got a chance to spend a little time with you guys and show you how grateful I am.
Thanks, Ala. Well, because you're a friend, if you don't mind, I want to take some phone calls.
Please.
A lot of people want to say hi. Wayne in Florida. Hey, Wayne, you're on the air.
What's up, Artie?
Hey, Wayne.
Man, I got to tell you, thank you, man. You saved my life when I was behind a fence at Florida State Prison, man. If it wasn't for you, I was getting ready to crack up pretty hard.
Really? You all right now?
Yeah. Oh, I'm straight as can be. I was going to my main camp, and I had just gotten with my wife and kids, so, like, I was really an emotional wreck. And for some weird reason, I was just north of Tallahassee, 40 miles, about a mile from the Georgia border, middle of nowhere. I could barely pick up two AM stations in the middle of the night. It was about 11 o'clock. I was in the bathroom playing with my radio, and I was able to pick up your signal coming out of Fort Lauderdale or Miami. You guys were on somewhere.
Wow.
Because you and Nick DiPaolo were on, and I listened for all the way to 1 o'clock, man. And
wow.
Back from the edge. I was really going to get messed up hard by them guards, man. I was missing my kids. I couldn't get through on the phone. My wife had just answered. I hadn't talked to her in 10 days. Yeah.
Man, well, I'm
catch your show now.
I'm glad you're all right, buddy, and thanks for the kind words.
Yeah, thank you. Actually, I listened to you down in Naples from the station in Tampa. The Bubba station, what is it, 102.5?
Yeah, the Bone or something, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
So, are you still going to be doing a podcast or anything, or is just that's it? No more.
I'll be doing some down the road, man. I got to keep doing this. It's all I know how to do, brother. So,
cool, man. Because I actually got some awesome advice from you about my diabetes. I was the same way you was. Wouldn't take my medicine. Matter of fact, I had a reading at like 390, and I was like, yeah, is that high, low?
That's
so
high.
I'm really going to start looking at it now that you... No, I mean, hearing what you went through, you know?
Yeah, it's controllable, brother. You just got to live the right way. And listen, I will definitely see you down the road. I appreciate the call, Wayne.
You got it. Thanks, Artie. Good luck, man.
All right, buddy. Thank you. Jake in Florida. Jake, you're on the air.
Hey, Artie.
Hey, Jake.
Hey, buddy. I'm in Ventura, California.
Oh, California. I'm sorry. There's like Jake in California. What's up?
Man, hey, here are the issues. I'm going to make them short and sweet.
Go ahead.
No, man, I've been following you, man. I couldn't believe the news, man, when you were hurt and you were suffering, and I was feeling for you, and I, man, it was so great when you came back on the air, and you know, and John Ritchie's very eloquent, and Mike Buscetti's hilarious, and I dug the whole thing, and I just, you know, I love you, man. I'm going to follow you wherever you go.
Thanks, Jake. That means a lot to me, Jake. It really does, and I appreciate it.
You know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
But you know, maybe one more thing. I mean, just I think Mark Kriegel might have been the death sentence.
Yeah, Kriegel Friday night. Kriegel's spot on Friday night.
The way that he sounds on the air. Yeah. You know, first of all, you ask him something.
That's hard.
Yeah.
No.
It's a rough room.
So your one note, Jake, is Les Kriegel.
Les Kriegel.
Okay, you got
my.
If I'm lucky enough to have another show, I will remember those two words, Les Kriegel.
Les Kriegel.
Okay. Jake, thanks, buddy. I appreciate it. Jake in California. Ken in Jersey. Ken.
Hey, Artie.
Hey, Ken.
Hey, thanks, man. Great show, and I'm sorry it's going away.
Thank you. Thank you, Ken. I appreciate the
call. It's been great. I mean, I've called in a bunch of times. First time I got through. Unfortunately, it's the last night. But the apps are phenomenal. I mean,
great.
If I miss it at night, I can catch it during the day. It was just amazing how some of that stuff worked. You guys really, really got your act together.
Well, great. And,
hopefully, you can just pick up everyone who's there, great crew, and plop them down somewhere else and get this thing going again.
Well, thanks, Ken. I appreciate you listening. And, yeah, keep watching out. We'll see you down the road, brother.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Well, goodbye, DirecTV. I loved it, man. It was the best thing on DirecTV.
Thanks, Ken. Take care, brother. Real quick, you're going to like this, Hala. Eric in New Orleans. Eric?
Who that?
Yeah, what's up, buddy?
It's for real, huh, bro?
Yeah, it's for real, brother.
Breaking my nuts. Yeah. I just learned about it listening, waiting online. It hurts. Yeah, about to cry. Your boy Bruce Springsteen's playing here Saturday at Jazz Fest. So why don't you come on down here then?
Are you going?
Yeah, well, I got to see Christian Aguilera on Friday. And
wow.
Eric, I got to say.
Christina Aguilera, then the boss.
Listen, I've been all over the country, all over the world, blah, blah, doing. Eric, I met in New Orleans when we were there. He's the scariest human being I've ever met.
Well, you terrified me the same.
But I say that with all due respect.
And I know the damn twins. They're the scariest people on the planet. Man.
Well, listen, you speak the truth.
Ew.
Thank you.
I can't believe it's true. I love you. listen back.
I love you. I love you too. I love you too. I'll see you soon. All right. I'll see you. I'll probably be in the same mental institution at some point.
Lake Pontchartrain.
You got it. And we'll talk about the good old days of John Ritchie and his bloody head. And
No way.
All right, Eric. Thanks, brother.
Who that? I love
you
all.
Love you. Take care. Eric from New Orleans was really a scary individual. That guy. You got to meet that guy.
I've been to New Orleans a couple of times, but I'll be on the lookout next time I'm down there.
Well, I'm glad you're here tonight. This is really appropriate because the Donald Sterling story is, I mean, everybody's talking about it. Let's play a little of the tape first.
Oh, let's.
And then look, you're a former NBA great. We could talk to you about this. Everybody interested in your opinion. I have a few myself.
Okay.
Let's hear a couple of clips that James has prepared.
If it makes you happy, I will remove all of the black people from my Instagram.
Oh, my God.
You said that before. You said, I understand.
I did remove the people that were...
She said that before?
He asked her before.
She said that... First of all, she said that before. If it makes you happy... the observation I have about this tape is... It's just two grotesque human beings.
Nasty people.
And they belong in Los Angeles. This is L.A. indigenous. That's what this is. This is just two gross human beings having a conversation. This disgusting whore, is just obviously just out for herself.
She's baiting him.
She's baiting him.
For sure.
Taping him, egging him on. She's just disgusting. Not enough people are saying that. And then, of course, him. Look, he's 80 years old. He's ignorant. The world has outgrown a guy like this. The guy's got a bunch of chips that he made. He's got to take them away from life's poker table. The world outgrew his views. Like, take your money and go home. And I'm sure that's what they're going to make him do.
Can we be really surprised? He's an 80-year-old guy who's basically, in the job he's had, put very little in. That Clippers team has been horrible.
Worst record in the NBA.
But it was in professional sports.
But it was
since
in LA.
Since 1981, when
right.
he bought
and it could make him money because it was in LA.
Well,
and he looked
thing,
at it
Artie.
Purely as a
he
business.
He sucked the teat of the NBA for about 28 years, putting very little in and getting the same back as the Bulls because it's a collective bargaining agreement.
Right.
They should get the same equal share in TV and all the other sponsorships league-wide. Now, the individual stuff that they do in certain cities, that's their own. But he got the same amount that the Bulls got the same year the Bulls won the championship. And they were in last place in the Pacific Division.
Right.
So what was the motivation? He did very little. Talk about people who are abusing the system and getting something for putting nothing in.
Yes.
It's the same thing he was making fun of. You know, the people that worked for him.
Sure.
He was guilty of doing it, too. It's a slave owner's mentality where he thinks, I don't mind making money off of you. I don't mind sleeping with you.
Right.
I don't mind taking complete advantage of you. But by no means are you any better than me. I'm a lot better than you.
Well,
that's the mentality.
You make a good point. Listen, another thing that's gross about this whole situation is if you have that view on race that this guy has about black people, whatever, and you go into the business of basketball, which is dominated by, black people.
Right.
You truly just look at them as like you're buying a tractor or something.
It's a product. It's cattle.
Yeah, it's just make me money, and I don't. You're not a human being.
No.
It's just an investment. If you have those views and you go into basketball, that's the only reason you would go in is money, not because you like the people that work for you or you really care about them. And, I'm sure a lot of people have known that's how he feels for a long time, and they just tolerated it.
Well, you've got to ask yourself, though, what about the NBA? They're partly to blame in this as well.
I agree. You don't think people knew this guy?
Well, think about it.
Everyone knew.
People forget a couple years back, I think it was maybe 7-8 years back, he would heckle Baron Davis, his own player.
Right.
In the middle of
the game. The guy's clearly nuts.
He would curse at his own player and say, I'm going to do everything I can to get you out of here.
I buy you clothes.
There are stories of him taking his female companions into the locker room after games and saying to him, commenting, look at their beautiful black bodies.
Yeah, but what does his wife think about this tape? His wife just defended him tonight.
He's out of his mind.
On Entertainment
so
Tonight.
Yeah, so is she.
She's in denial like Sandusky's wife is in denial.
Well, that's the thing. His wife, who sometimes makes it to the games with him, other times it's just a woman,
a
hooker, or his last...
Whatever.
This woman who recorded this conversation.
I'm the only one allowed to bring black people to the games.
Yeah, he's unbelievable. I mean,
is so funny. He's just gross. Let's hear a little more of it.
I didn't move Matt Kemp and Magic Johnson.
Why?
But I thought Matt Kemp is mixed. and he was okay, just like me. He's lighter and whiter than me. I met his mother.
I love it. He's like, okay.
You think I'm a racist? And
I don't think you're a racist.
Yes, you do. Yes, you do.
Yes, you do. No, why do you? You think I'm a racist?
Obviously, yeah. Well, that's another
thing. It's a retarded conversation.
Listen, he's an 80-year-old man set in his ways. He's never
heard. How does a guy this stupid get that much money? Well, it must not be that hard in this
real
country.
Estate.
Well, he's in real estate, but he's a slumlord.
He was an ambulance chaser first.
Was he?
Yeah, that's how he started. He was a lawyer, personal injury lawyer. That's how he made money.
He's not a very good man.
That's what not at all.
Yeah, the stories of him like throwing blacks out of his.
He said when he apparently, this is again alleged because he wasn't convicted in the courtroom, but I read some of the transcripts. So there was the people that worked for him, the property managers, would testify against him in this proceeding. And she said that when he would instruct her on how to take care of people in the buildings, he would say, listen, ignore them. Don't take care of the blacks and the Mexicans. Yeah. They're the ones that smell because all they do is sit around all day, do nothing, they don't wash, and they smoke and drink.
Well, you know, listen, again. Wow.
That is his perception, but he doesn't mind taking their rent money, though.
Well, that's what
See,
I mean.
That's the hypocrisy of it all.
If you have enough money, first of all, lawsuits and stuff, if you have enough money, and this is what's scary about this country, if you have enough money, you can make stuff disappear.
Sure.
Before it ever gets to court.
Right.
If you pay the right lawyers, and lawyers are sleazes, they'll do whatever they have to do for money. The one credit I'll give this broad is she finally took him down.
Absolutely.
But, I mean, at the age of 80, the guy's been living like this forever.
Right. He's been a bad person for a long time.
He's clearly nuts. She's almost retarded and just sleazy. And it's just a funny conversation between two crazy people.
Yep.
Life has outgrown his ignorant views. He's got to take his chips and leave the game.
I think if he wasn't the owner of an NBA basketball team that employed black people, the head coach is a black person, I don't think it would be that big of a deal. In other words, it would be kind of like the Clive and Bundy guy out in Nevada. Yeah. Are we surprised that he's a racist?
Right.
Are we surprised that he says black people would be better off in slavery than this public subsidies?
Right.
When he's getting public subsidies for the last 20 years, not paying his bills on the grazing fees, he's the absolute hypocrite too. So are we really surprised? No, I think the problem with Sterling is he employs people.
Of course.
And I think that's the problem.
I mean, listen.
You can say no to people as far as jobs, take away their livelihoods. He's in that position.
Including this girl. I mean, he's saying to her, if you don't do what I want, I'll go get another girl.
Owns
he's employing her.
She's in his life.
She said, she's mixed.
Well, I'm
surprised. She's Mexican and black.
Right.
I'm surprised she didn't try to blackmail him first. That would have been the move. Like, she could have got $50 million for that tape. His lawyers he probably thinks nothing's wrong with it, but his lawyers would have went, look, pay her.
Right. You got to pay her. Right.
And so she went the other way. She wanted to be more famous. She's fame. That's L.A. She's more fame hungry than money hungry.
No question. No question.
Clearly, she wants to be a star.
Here's the thing, too. Here's the thing she can fall back on. She could always find someone to take care of her.
Of course.
But that person who takes care of her, the next guy coming up, he may not make her famous. So she's going to get her fame, and then the next guy coming up would be more than happy to take care of everything she needs.
Look, she made a bad move. She's already a joke. She's a punchline already. And she didn't get the money. She should have blackmailed him for $50 million and just lived her life.
It's just again,
now she's famous for being a joke.
I think the good thing is that she did do us a service in that one less guy in a position now.
Well, she took him down. That's for sure.
Yeah, that's the thing. She's a joke until this turns around and she gets paid. Because the way that this sounds, the way that it sets up, she's baiting him. You know,
absolutely.
It's totally obvious. I mean, is there some backstory that we don't know about
treated her like he treats his players and his tenants and everybody else in his life. He probably took her for granted, mistreated her, and this is her way of getting back at him.
When money's involved, it's a complicated situation.
She's smarter than we think.
Well, I don't listen. If she was smart, who's going to pay her now?
Right.
She played all her cards.
Right. She took it to TMZ for nothing.
Yeah, she turned her cards over. You know,
right.
I mean, and if Oprah or anybody wants to interview this broad, if they're smart, they'll lowball a price because she just wants to be famous.
Right.
That's what she's hungry for. Clearly,
anybody's saying her name.
You know, I mean, she might get some sort of representation who says, look, let's make some money. It's going to be minimal.
What's with the one initial first name? What's that all about?
I don't know. She probably thought that'll make her more famous.
Did she have delusions of grandeur earlier on that she was already famous and the name would just, she'd fill out the name one day?
Yeah. What was her story before she was his sometimes.
No clue, man. Don't get me to guessing, because the number are going to be good
guesses. I think she did some modeling, and
some derivative.
I think she was on American Idol.
Was she? No.
No, listen, I mean, it's just a really crazy conversation. Whiny voice is my favorite. Do I not pay them? Do I not give them shoes?
I told you the story off camera about what one of my owners
said.
We're at a barbecue in the summer. I won't mention a name or the team I played for. And we're taking a tour right before the afternoon barbecue. And as he's taking us around, we go into his pool room, and he had a Persian rug on the floor. And the Persian rug has writing similar to Arabic writing. He assumed I could read it.
And you're Arabic.
I'm Arabic. Yeah. I'm Arabic, but I'm not Persian. So I tried to explain to him that I couldn't translate that. And in a joking manner, even though it wasn't funny, he turned around and said, "Oh, nonetheless, it probably says kill all the Arabs." And I remember thinking about, and he
was
laughed.
Was it just you and him in the room?
No. Laugh. It was me and about 10 other people. But none of them were ball players. They were all front office people. So right. They all gave an
they
uncomfortable
all fake laugh.
Laugh. Exactly. But I remember being stunned. Well. And I remember the menu had, like we had mentioned, filet mignon and lobster. And I could not eat a thing because I was disillusioned. I was disgusted because this guy at the bottom of the checks that I was cashing, there was his name.
It's your boss, yeah.
What do you think about what the Clippers did? I mean, they played, they kind of put up a little protest wearing the black wristbands, and they took their warm-ups and turned them inside out.
Well,
and
here's
threw
where it's
the jerseys in the middle of the...
Here's where it's complicated. When money's involved, it's complicated. I'm not blaming or discrediting Paul or Griffin, but they're not going to rip up their checks
no
and
question.
Throw them in the middle.
That
would be a real protest,
and they're
but
not gonna
it's
tank,
money.
They're not going to tank a game either because there are playoff shares in the NBA. When you advance, you get more...
Why hurt themselves?
But in essence, they ended up tanking the game because of all of the commotion and distraction that this is
created.
Sterling tanked it.
He was their own worst enemy. You're absolutely right. He was tougher than the Golden State Warriors
right.
the other day. Yeah.
Right. Well, that's the thing. All of the backlash, you know, but behind closed doors, every second I heard, every second that they've been communicated with on Twitter or, you know, online in
Facebook,
any way
whatever,
or
right.
family calling or someone saying something.
Right.
That's taking away from time that they needed to prepare.
No question. Well, you guys are both pros. You know better than anybody.
Absolutely.
That took a lot of time.
Oh, well, here's the thing, and I was mentioning on some other radio show this morning. In the NBA, like in the pros, you get interviewed before the game.
Yeah.
So now if 20, 30 people come in and they're a gaggle and they talk to you about this constantly.
That's all they're going
to
talk
how
about.
How are you supposed to shut down and then go, okay, I got to cover Seth Curry tonight. Right. What does he do on pick and roll? I mean, it's unbelievably distracting. So, yeah, you have only Donald Sterling to thank for that.
And
for
if
that
you're, the other you're the other team's coach and you're a motivator, you go right for that jugular.
Absolutely.
Well,
that's the thing. Mark Jackson came out and said he doesn't believe that Clippers fans should show up for this next game.
Magic Johnson said he'll never go to another Clipper game, which is a moot point because he's clearly not allowed.
Well, he wants to buy it. Yeah.
Magic, I hate to break this to you. You're not allowed at the game.
Well, they're saying Magic's group wants to buy the
Clippers. Well, here's the thing.
I think that'd be great.
Black people should go to the game in droves now. They should sit right behind them. They should sell all the tickets.
Again, the idea of he doesn't mind black people sitting some other parts of his arena. He just doesn't want them sitting next to him.
The whole thing is crazy.
With his girlfriend.
It's archaic and
that's
nuts.
That's the whole point. If she brings him, he's going to have to sit next to him.
Well, as sleazy as his broad is, she brought this guy down. Like Nixon got brought down by...
Good for her.
Well, that's the thing. Can you believe it took this? The fact is, since 1981, he's been the owner there, and rumors have been circulating. Not just rumors. Facts have been circulating about this guy, about Sterling's racism. Everyone knew. Everyone in the league knew, but there was nothing that anyone did until potentially now.
Right, right,
you know
right.
what
we
sucks?
Don't know what's going to come down tomorrow, what the ruling's going to be on
you
that.
You know what sucks? The guy bought the team for $12 million. It's worth $575
more
million.
More than that, Artie. They said, if you think of the way...
The guy knows what he's doing.
Sacramento got sold for $535,000. This team's in L.A., and they're better.
Right. Yeah.
They're going to make more than that. But here's another point. Bill Roden, who writes...
Wait, hold on. I got to take a break. I'm sorry, but I want to hear... Just hold on to that.
Sure.
Absolutely. We're going to come back. Al's going to make his point. We'll talk more about this. hopefully more about actual basketball. And there's a ton of phone calls want to say goodbye. I'll try to get to all of them. Back after this on the Artie Lang Show. Are you looking for an easy way to spoil your dog while helping a good cause? BarkBox.com serves dog parents, people who are obsessed with spoiling their pups and giving them the very best. BarkBox helps dog parents make their best friend happy by discovering the best toys, gadgets, treats, and products that the special pup in your life will love. BarkBox delivers a curated package of 4 to 6 items straight to your door once per month, and they donate 10% to rescue centers and shelters across the U.S. BarkBox is the perfect gift for the crazy dog parents in your life. And each purchase will contribute to efforts to save the 7 million animals who enter shelters each year. Go online today and get BarkBox for as little as $17 per month. All edibles are made in the U.S. or Canada, and shipping is free to the lower 48 states. Visit BarkBox.com/Artie, A-R-T-I-E, and get 20% off your first order. Again, that's BarkBox.com/Artie. Welcome back to the Artie Lang Show. Al Abdelhabi's here. A bunch of your calls. I want to say goodbye on the last show here tonight. Mike in Cali. Mike, you're on the air.
Hi, how are you? Artie Lang?
Yeah, Mike, what's up, buddy?
Hey, I actually called in a while back, and I told you you did a great job picking John Ritchie as your co-host. And
thanks.
Mike Boschetti was sick that day. Mm. And I wanted to say that you have a wonderful show, and it's absolutely awful that they canceled you.
Well, thanks, Mike. I appreciate it. It was a business decision, but you know that happens sometimes. But I appreciate the kind words.
You will be missed on the show you are on right now, and I'm so you were very kind to me when I called the first time, and thank you very much for listening to me. And you have a really cool setup there, where the girls answer the calls, and it's really professional, and it's going to be really missed. You're really going to be missed. And before I go, I wanted to say on Friday, Mel from Boston called, and she's actually that girl that liked Boschetti, and like when he was posting his like Instagram.
Yeah, with the girl loved him.
Yeah, and you made her not be able to contact. You said don't actually contact Boschetti. It would probably be best if you kind of ran like a little buffer for him. But then like when she called in like on Friday, you it was like you all didn't recognize her. I just wanted you. Hello?
Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead.
I just wanted you to give a shout out to her to call in one more time and get everything all set up for Boschetti.
Hook up for Mike.
Show.
Well, you know what, Mike? That's a good idea.
Good
so
catch,
we'll,
bud.
We'll try to get Mel if you're listening. Definitely call.
She
back.
Sounded cute. That, was, to
that,
a hot
that,
one.
That was going to be my summer job, though, was to get Mike laid.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Believe me,
you've had easier jobs.
I mean, I was going to put devote full time to it on show and off show.
Guarding Horace Grant was probably much easier.
Reach out to the people, social network.
I think guarding Horace Grant the pain was much easier than Mike laid. But Mike in California going, hello. Apparently a lot of people do hang up on him, I think. Mm. Karen in Boston. Karen, what's up?
Hello, Artie. Artie, I'm so bummed. I can't believe it. Oh, my goodness.
You'll be all right. I appreciate the call.
You'll be all right, too. You're too funny to not be on some sort of a show soon. And I just wanted to say thank you for all the laughs. And I was a Howard Stern fan first. And then when you came on the Howard show, you instantly became my favorite. I don't even listen to Howard anymore, but I followed the show for however long it's been on. And wherever you end up, I'll definitely be there. And I just want to wish you luck and everyone else on the show good luck, too.
You're a good person, Karen. You've been here since the beginning, I remember. So thanks. Yeah. For being so loyal, and we'll see you down the road, all right?
Definitely. Next time you're in Boston, I'll definitely be at the show.
You got it, Karen.
Love you, Artie. Take care.
Love you, too. Take care. Joe in Florida. Joe.
Artie.
Hey.
How you doing, bro?
Pretty good, brother. Pretty good. How you doing?
Good, man. Listen, I just want to congratulate you on an amazing show. I've listened for years. I'm only 25 years old, and I remember when I was, you know, a young kid, I used to sneak and hide from my parents and listen to the Howard Stern show with you on it.
Are you in jail right now, Joe?
No, I'm not. I'm on my back porch right now.
Good. Well, I'm glad I raised you.
But listen, yeah, when I was a little kid, you know, I want to thank you for exposing me to things that I should have not exposed to.
Yeah, I'm thinking back now, and there was a lot of crazy stuff there. But look, no problem. Everybody needs that every once in a while.
Grew up
listen,
fast.
I love Beer League. It's one of my favorite comedies of all time.
Wow.
You're an amazing performer. You just done a great job, bro. And thanks for all the laughs over the years, my whole life. You know, I'm a young kid. Thanks for all the laughs. And, keep it going.
Thanks, Joe. Well, that's really nice, Joe. Thanks, buddy. And I'll try to keep the laughs coming down the road, buddy. Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks for the call, Joe. Arm in Long Island. Arm's a long time listener. I know. Arm, what's up, buddy?
Dreaming, I must be dreaming. I know I just fall in love again. Just one touch and then it happens every time. And
I know I just
fall in love. Ann Murray, clearly a big fan.
Guys, I want to say this, and this is a community, it's your biggest online community, dogshed.com. They have been analyzing your every chin since the day you started. Kev, I de soir, release, it, I love bacon, all of them. Beth Zygote, whomever. They are just rabid art. They make me look like Chelsea Handler, for crying out loud.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that.
I got a little treat for Allah.
Yeah.
Allah is such what an underrated word on the show. I am a huge NBA head, as you know, and a friend of mine sent me Wayman Tisdale footage, 1992.
That's right.
Wow.
This dude somehow changed the channel, and he recorded SportsCenter highlights of Allah's best game.
Wow. That's great. You caught the one, huh?
12 for 13 from the field. I have it right
nice.
Here. I have it right here.
Wow.
Dan Patrick, Keith Olbermann, call on your highlights. Get ready for this.
And then Allah, the jump. Out of distractions to that ball, I will score. Blows right by the former Xavier Musketeer, T-Time Hill. And then Allah, the jumper over Victor Alexander. Don Nelson says, that's that Duke kid, that Allah Abdelnaby. Yes, Robert Parrish to Allah.
Tyrone Hill is in trouble.
And it counts.
And Abdelnaby.
The Celtics on the fast break, and guess who's going to end up with it? Allah Abdelnaby. 8 for 8 from the floor in the first half. Celtics up by 13. Chris Ford says, Allah wants it. Get it to Allah. And they do exactly that. 9 for 9. Nelson says, come on. This is Allah Abdelnaby? Yes. You cannot stop him. You couldn't even contain him.
Wow.
12 of 13 from the floor. Obviously getting pumped up for those Duke Blue Devils as they look to pick up another title. And
wow.
Allah picks up the victory. 114-88. One of his best moves for the next.
I love that. Our friend Dan Patrick, too, yeah.
Absolutely. And you held on to that, man. Wow.
Arm, that's something else. Thanks, buddy. That was great.
That's incredible. Thank you so much.
You said you knew I was gifted, but you never told me just how much.
Thanks, Arm. We got to cut him.
I wanted to gong him again, but I can't. That was kind.
Arm, don't take that the wrong way. You're one of my favorite callers. Thank you for listening, but the singing was a bit much. But how about that?
Really cool, right?
Yeah, that's
really
great.
Cool. He caught the one good game I had in my career.
12 of 13.
Yeah.
Field,
listen, man, the sun shines on a dog's butt every once in a while. But Golden, it was Golden State, man. They didn't play any defense. Don Nelson's teams didn't
still,
play any
man. Defense.
No, that was good. That was a good night.
I also want to thank, I'll remind you, I want to thank Dan Patrick, too, and all the Danettes over there. They've always been nice to me since I've been here, very supportive of me. So thank you. And the Danettes, all the guys over there, Paul and Seton and what's the kid's name? What's the guy? I know McLovin and Fritzy. Fritzy I love. So those guys, much thanks, many thanks, and many more good years on the air. Thank you, Dan Patrick. Good man. Josh in Tennessee. Josh.
Hey, how you doing, Art?
What's up, buddy?
Oh, not much. Just calling you tornado.
What? You're in a tornado?
Sounds like it.
Got tornadoes coming through the area, man. Just calling to tell you we love you down here. Hate to see you go. Didn't I know it was the last episode until. I haven't watched it in about a week and a half, but Man, caught the news about an hour ago, and hate to hear that, bud.
Well, listen, calling during a tornado is probably the most touching thing ever. Thank you. Just batting down the hatches. Are you safe?
I'm down in the basement.
Oh, man. Wow, that's devotion right there.
Dude,
man.
Be careful.
He's
down
in the basement with his life on the line thinking about you,
and he
man.
Called. That is
pretty cool, man.
That is touching.
That is all right.
I got a bar over here. If I got to run under it, I'm safe. But I had a question for Mike.
Hey, Josh. How are you, buddy? Be safe. I'll put you in my prayers, buddy.
Is that the last voice you want to hear during a tornado? All right, listen. We got to take a break. I think Josh. Thank you so much.
Well,
stay
he had a
safe.
Question for Mike.
So, does he have a question for Mike?
Yeah.
Quick question. Yeah, just wanted to know, Mike, what are you going to do as far as getting clothes now? Are you
I got a whole closet full of stuff, Josh. I'll be set for like 4 or 5 years.
By the way, DirecTV called me. They do want them back. They'd like that. They feel they own them.
Okay, whatever.
They like the eye. They like them washed thoroughly and sent.
Oh, God.
All right, Josh, you be well, brother. Thanks for the call.
Hey, thank you, bro.
I love you, man. Tennessee during a tornado calling. Very touching. We're going to come back. That Ala tape was great.
It was.
Thanks,
man.
Arm.
That was really cool, Arm. Good. Thank you.
And thanks for mentioning that website that likes the show. We'll be back after this.
Do more than watch. Follow Artie and the show on Twitter at Artie Lang Show.
Welcome back to the Artie Lang Show. Twitter is, some of the people on Twitter are hilarious. A lot of people expressing their opinion about the show ending. One guy, I hope this kid is of age and doesn't live with his parents, pounding scotch in honor of Artie Lang. All he says, pounding.
Artie Lang's Twitter account on Twitter.
Yeah, pounding scotch. I want to say thanks to the French Quarter for a last time. Thanks to French Quarter's guest apartments for being our New York City hotel. It's the last night at our New York City hotel.
Yeah,
you right. Love them, right?
I do.
You're probably not going to be.
Help me out.
You're going to have to pay for tonight.
I'm going to charge you double tonight.
When you get there, your things will be on the curb on 46th Street with a sticker of Chris Long's face.
Oh,
thanks
no.
For the laugh, Joe.
Oh, man.
Isn't it so funny? It may be true.
Just doubly boxed up. The maitre d' will be like, sir, can off, you please leave?
Off you go. Off you go.
We were called. This credit card no longer works. We have a paying customer coming in. Could you please leave? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ritchie.
Vacate the premises.
I'm sure you were a great fullback. Thank you. Thank you. Go to FrenchQuarter.com. To book your next day, FrenchQuartersNY.com. To book your next day. Let us know. Dude, come to my place. Yeah. Call me. Call me before I change my number. I will be changing my number in the morning. But, I hope if you have need a place to stay, I have a room.
Thank you.
Stuff being you. Packed up as we speak.
The sad thing is the kids are on the street also.
Yeah. Paul Pabst is moving into your room right now. There's a big sticker on your stuff of Dan Patrick going.
Oh, man.
Hey, John.
Yeah. Oh.
Heard the Sheridan has a vacancy.
Oh, my goodness.
There's a Best Western F Motel on 10th Avenue.
Remember that Friday you didn't want to go on a show, John? There you go.
Exactly. Mm.
My stomach hurts.
Anyway, Justin and Cali, a bunch of California people.
Oh, my God, man. Tell me it isn't true. I'm a half hour into the first. I'm way behind, and I just heard
probably the worst day of my life, man.
I don't worry. Stuff will get worse.
Dude, you guys are playing it off like it's all. But this show was the greatest show on TV, and it's just a shame that DirecTV's head set up so far up their asses, man.
And don't blame them. Blame me.
Come on, dude. This show, there was nothing like this.
That's the problem.
Come on, Artie.
Should have been a little more like Mike and Mike.
It was a modern day.
More bobbleheads.
What?
You and Mike Ricchetti, Ralph Cramden, Ed Norton.
I know.
Come on.
I know. Well, listen, I wish we could still bring it to you, but everything comes to an end, man. I appreciate the call, buddy.
Howard's still going, man. You were the best thing other than
well,
Howard.
Well, Howard makes the company $50 million a year. That's why. We ran out and said no.
What an ass.
All the stuff's going to be loaded out of the refrigerator in a second.
Right.
They're moving Bichetti as we speak.
Start dismantling the studio.
Bichetti's nest is being dismantled as we speak.
I feel like Chuck and Happy Days.
The Danettes come in and just rip Mike's shirt off. Well, Justin, I really appreciate it, buddy, and I'll see you down the road. That's my slogan.
All right, man.
All right, buddy. Thanks for the call. Good call. I don't know if it's Reddy or Reedy in South Carolina. Reddy? Reedy?
Red.
Ew.
What's up, man? It's Red.
What's going on?
Oh, come on, man. You getting off the air?
Yeah, well, yeah, for now. For now.
I hear you, man. I want to tell you, I went through a really tough time last year, and you kept me going, man.
Well, listen, I'm glad I was able to do that. You all right now?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Good. I'm glad.
Hey, man, remember I told you I'm a fish down here in South Carolina?
Yeah.
And I told you and Richie y'all need to come go fishing with me.
Well, we'd love to. I would love to.
Yeah, man. I'd come see me in the Keys and the fall, see you down there.
Tarpon.
Keys in the fall. That sounds like fun.
Yeah, it does.
I wanted to call you. I heard the boy a minute ago say he hadn't watched the show in like a week. Me neither.
Good. Okay.
Took me off guard a little while ago, you know?
I hear you. Mm-hmm. Well, listen, unfortunately, he was a great caller, but we got to take a break. The whole country calling in. Very, very nice. The Artie Lang Show after. Amazon is a proud sponsor of the Artie Lang podcast and offers a small percentage of your Amazon purchases to help support this program. In order to keep this program free, I kindly ask that you access my unique Amazon landing page prior to making any purchases online. The easiest way to access my Amazon page is by clicking on the Artie Lang landing page at podcastone.com. Click on the Amazon banner and save the URL as your go-to Amazon search page for future use. Every time you purchase anything from that saved URL, URL, a small percentage of your purchases comes back to produce this podcast. Now back to the show. Welcome back to the show. Some celebrities are, are celebrities to us. Guests of the show in the past who have tweeted nice things about us ending, and I want to say thank you. Brent Stover, Maggie Gray, Chris Mannix, Tim Doyle, Casey Stern, and the great Mark Kriegel, even though some of the fans think he was the cause of this.
I love Kriegel.
You guys are all great. Thank you, guys. I appreciate it. Kriegel's one of the best writers on the planet.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Especially with sports. David and Cali, another Cali. You're on the air.
Hey, Hardy. How's it going?
Good.
Hey, so I found out about this is your last show, and it's like I came home and DirecTV stepped on my puppy.
Again, DirecTV.
I had a brand new puppy. I just got DirecTV, and I got turned on to your show about 6 months ago. And it's like I came home and they stepped on my puppy.
Well, listen, DirecTV's, keep watching it. It's a great service. I appreciate the kind words, though. Thank you.
Hey, are you coming to San Francisco anytime soon? Aren't you coming in the summer? Or?
I'll be at the Punchline in sometime in the late summer. Absolutely, look for me. Without question, I'll be at the Punchline in San Francisco for like maybe three nights in a row. It's one of my favorite clubs in the country. In the late summer, I'm going to be there. Yeah.
Cool. Thanks for taking my call, Artie. This was great. And I'm gonna come and see you in San Francisco.
Check me out at the Punchline. It's one of the best clubs in the country. Thank you.
Right on, Artie.
Thanks, Dave. Thanks. Really appreciate all the calls. Chris DeStefano. Is Chris here yet? Did Chris get here? No, he's not here yet? Okay. Well, listen, I hope Alec can stick around.
Not going anywhere, brother.
Okay, good. Yeah. Because Chris, you know, DeStefano is a comic who was an All-American basketball player.
Is that right?
In high school. Yeah, he'd love to talk to you. So, and he's a funny guy, too. So Chris is coming up in the final hour. Alan's going to stick around. More of your calls. Everybody calling in, tweeting. And, again, thanks to all the former guests of the show who have tweeted. And we'll be back with the final hour of the Artie Lang Show on DirecTV after this. I'll never go to another Clipper game, which is a moot point because he's clearly not allowed.
Well, he wants to buy it.
All right, let's face it, folks. Sending online flowers sucks. Uh-huh. Yeah, we've all been burned by the $19.99 somehow turning into like $74.50, and what shows up isn't what you ordered, and it's mostly dead. And then you get spammed nonstop. Well, that's why the geniuses at The Books launched a whole new way to send flowers. TheBooks.com. You know, Books, because they took bouquets and just simplified the whole deal. TheBooks.com sends flowers straight from sustainable farms located on an active volcano in South America. And check this out, they charge a flat rate of just $40 with free delivery. Wow! And for this Mother's Day, TheBooks.com is offering 15% off plus free shipping when you use the promo code ARTIE. So go to TheBooks.com, that's TheBooks.com, then click on the shop button at the top of the page and send that special someone a book. And don't forget, order today and use that promo code ARTIE. You save 15% and you get free shipping on flowers from a freaking volcano. Ha! Huh.
Live from New York City, this is the Artie Lang Show. Here's Artie.
Welcome back to the Artie Lang Show. Last Artie Lang Show, Al Abdelnaby's here, one of our best guests ever. I'm glad he's here tonight.
Happy to be here, brother, really.
Yeah, really overwhelmed by this response here, both on Twitter and the calls. Kim in Texas. Broads are calling. Kim, you're on the air.
Hi.
How you doing, sweetie?
Artie, what am I going to do? Now I have to go to sleep.
I'm sorry.
I got nothing to do now, honey. You are so loved. You are such family. You're my little Italian cousin.
Oh, wow, that's
and you are loved and adored by my brother, my dear departed. My mom loved you. She was always worried you were going to go to Italy and make mozzarella with your retarded cousins.
They're just inbred. They're not fully retarded. They do live in a mud hut.
You are so loved.
Thank you, Kim. God, if this is the response now, what's going to happen 5 years from now when I die?
Oh. He said it off air, too. Kim, it's not funny, man.
Kim from Texas. No. By the way, when Kim from Texas says Italian, we all know you're black. Italian and black is the same to you in Texas, right, Kim?
Hey, honey, I'm a half-breed, part Mexican, part Norwegian. I don't know what I'm doing.
Nice. That sounds like a hot... You sound hot. That sounds a hot combination.
I was.
Oh, I was.
Damn, all the broads who were hot are cool.
Hey, Dad came from New York, came to Texas, and got lost.
So. Oh. Well, Kim, thank you.
You are so loved, and much luck, and much success, and... Good luck with everything, darling. You are loved.
Okay, Kim. Look for me in the future. Thank you.
Can't wait to see you.
Bye bye, Kim in Texas. Yeah, that Southern drawl does have a way of it loans itself to racism.
And at times it can sound really sexy, and sometimes it's the worst turnoff ever. You know, it all depends.
I'll tell you, Southern belle, oh man, those hot chicks.
Exactly.
I did stand up once at SMU. Okay.
Uh-huh. Sure, Dallas.
My head almost exploded.
Because there's a lot of good-looking girls.
Good-looking girls.
Yeah.
I was like, my head almost exploded.
Yeah.
I banged a four.
Did you?
I had to do something.
You were picky that night?
Yeah.
You weren't going to come away empty-handed, right?
I banged an SMU four, though. That's a Staten Island.
It's all relative.
That's a Staten Island nine, bro. Well, you know, know, Mike, at the gigs, you got to take what comes up, you know. What,
Staten Island 9 Plus, for sure.
You're a Staten Island 9, Mike.
Oh, I'm the Staten Island 12. I think.
David in Indiana. David.
Hey, Artie.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, man. Hey, just got to be a fan of you probably about a year ago.
Thank you.
But I really got into you and John and old Mike Buschetti. It was great. It was great.
I appreciate it, buddy. Thank you. That's so you're newer to the show, and I appreciate the kind words.
Yeah, man, it's just I just get into something good. I was just flipping through the channels one night, and it kind of caught my eye because I watch it on DirecTV, and I just enjoyed it. You know, I really did enjoy it.
Well, thank you. You know what? Some as a replacement, some people say Game of Thrones is good. You might want to try that.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
By the way, this just in a bulletin. The cast of Rogue has just moved into John Ritchie's room. 3 of the cast of Rogue have moved into the John Ritchie's room with a friend there. And Brock is boxing up his stuff. Brock's going to do an Andre the Giant impression when he kicks you out.
Yeah.
Goodbye, right. Goodbye. Goodbye, John Ritchie. It'll suck not to see Brock anymore. I was starting to get into Brock.
Yeah.
I call him all the time, Art. I'm going to go see him in L.A., I think.
Well, that's sorry for him.
Film that.
Yeah. Now, when you call Brock, is he happy that you call
him? Yeah, we talk a lot, as much as we can.
Oh, my God. Robbie in Kentucky. Here we go. Robbie, what's up?
Artie, what's up?
How you doing, man?
Man, I've eaten 12 Percocets since this show started.
Wow, me too.
This is so depressing, man. I've been listening since probably 02, since Stern. And what else are they going to put on at 2 a.m. in the morning for people to watch it?
Yeah, I don't know. Well, listen, it wasn't the greatest time slot, but what I love about this time slot is people like you listen. I love you're more interesting than the person who might call at, say, noon or something.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
No, I enjoy it. No one calls at noon who's had 12 Percocet. They're all asleep. But are you okay, Rob? I'm worried about you. Everything all right?
I'm all right. I think.
Well, that's a good answer. Okay. That's a good answer. We'll see.
Yeah, I was going to say, man, you're the funniest person I've ever even been a fan of. Comedy aside, conversationally, off the cuff, you're the funniest person I've ever heard on radio, TV, even on the Stern Show. I love Howard, but he made that show up a lot.
Wow. Well, that's a great compliment. Thank you. I mean, you know, people on 12 Percocet are honest. I've noticed that. When you take 12 Percocet, you're honest. So that's a real compliment. When you take 12 Percocet, you're fat. You'll say that to a woman. You'll say that to a stripper when you're on 12 Percocet. But, Rob, so that's a real compliment. Thank you.
Hey, will you do one thing for me before you get off here?
What is it? Sure.
Will you give the signal to James to hang up on me? Craig.
You got it, buddy. Rob, take care. Brush your hands. He was dying to have that.
He wanted to be eggs.
He's officially a part of the show. Well, you know, I'll is Rod from Bayside on? Rod. Rod?
What a terrible night.
I know. What are you going to do with yourself? You know, I'm sure Mike and Michael are the Francesa calls.
I do want to thank you for letting me be a part of the show, like a tiny part of the show, and, you know, having me up to the studio a few times. Like,
Rod, let me tell you something. You were not a tiny part of the show. You were a huge part of the show. Your calls were always hilarious, and it made my job easier. When I saw that Rod had calls, I was like, it's going to be an easier night just to get laughs, because they were always great, and I appreciate it.
Well, and thank you for saying that, but it was also a really special thing for me, knowing that, like, you know, something I did can make you laugh.
No, listen, absolutely.
I've always been a fan of yours.
When I first met you, I said, well, this kid would have to pretty much light himself on fire to make me laugh. But then I saw your girlfriend, and I said, I got to take him seriously. He's got a smoking hot chick. Look, Rod, you're a funny guy, man. Keep up the comedy.
I'm gonna keep making prank calls in case you go to another, another venture.
Dude, honestly,
I'll be backloaded.
I can't say officially, but stockpile some up.
All right, you got it.
Okay.
No problem. I'm going to use those Donald Sterling tapes to make some pranks.
Rod, you're on the air. Do I buy you clothes, Mike? Do I buy them clothes? Excuse me? Do I buy them shoes and sneakers?
You sound like Chris Penn a little bit.
Yeah, you're right.
I'd love to sound like Chris Penn. Yeah. He was one of my heroes. Yeah, well, that would be amazing. So start doing that. Use the Broad's voice, too. She's unbelievable.
Oh, you got it.
All right, we'll talk.
I think my my favorite memory of the show, though, is when you told me to go to the Super Bowl parade and that you'd meet me there and to bring some vitamin water, and you never showed up.
Yeah. Well, Rod, let me tell you something. If you really fell for that, I feel very sorry for it.
No, I was going anyway. I'm a huge Giants fan.
Of course you were. Yeah, you didn't really think I'd show up, right?
I did have the vitamin water.
I did show up. I told security from afar to keep you away.
I sent one last prank call that I did. It was when I was doing the thing where I was getting them to answer their own questions.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So I sent one last one in for you.
Do we have it? Oh, that's great. That's amazing. Okay, here we go. The last Rod from Bayside prank call.
Let's go to Anthony in Manhattan. Anthony, what's going on?
How are you?
I'm doing all right.
Do you expect any acquisitions by the Yankees picking up any other players, or this is probably what you got?
I think 99% is pretty much what you got. The only thing you could wonder if somebody gets cut that they didn't expect, but I think this is pretty much what they have. And I'm just curious what happens if anything happens to Johnson. I mean, who's filling in for him? He's the jack of all trades for every other position. That's my only concern. But I think that's pretty much it. Unless, like I said, let somebody, you know, some minor guy to pick up, but that'll be about it.
That was a tape of that guy.
Right. Yeah.
That's his own voice.
He's doing both sides of the interview.
No, but no.
Rod
has a tape of that guy. Uh-huh. It's so brilliant, it's hard to explain.
Right.
Rod has a tape of that guy from an earlier show.
Oh, and he's just
asking that question.
Oh, my God.
The guy answered himself. Asking a question.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
That's
the best beautiful. One was Brian Jones answering himself.
The Brian Jones one is. Yeah. Do we have that? Let's do a little Rod retrospect. Do we have the Brian? This is Brian Jones who does football. Well, let's listen to this one.
And he's sticking to it. Let's go to Brian in New York City. Hi, Brian. Welcome to CBS Sports Radio.
What's up, buddy?
It's all good. Where'd you go?
I'm talking about this Earthling comment. I read it totally different than all these people were freaking out. You know, he basically said, I'm disappointed. The guy was here 14 years. We only won one Super Bowl. He wasn't blaming that on Peyton Manning.
No, I think he was blaming what we talked about a lot and what will be talked about a lot, and that is if you're going to pay a guy this much money and it's a cap league, then you have to win if you're going to expend that kind of money. Otherwise, let somebody else spend that kind of money.
Amazing.
And we're starting over with someone we don't have to pay that much.
I'm happier than a warden in a women's prison with a fistful of parks.
Oh, my God. Jones likes that.
He stole it from me.
I know he did. I know he did.
It sounded like me.
I don't know what just happened, but that was you.
You know, what did you do?
I have no idea what happened, but that was you.
Where?
I don't know.
Where?
That was 100% Brian Jones' voice.
Oh, what are you doing? Are you mixing and scratching?
I have no idea what just happened.
He has no idea what just happened.
The best line in the history of radio. I don't know what just happened, but that was you. I don't know what just happened, but that was you.
Oh, that was great.
Oh, Rod, those are priceless, brother. So thank you.
No, thank you guys for all the hours of entertainment. Tongue punch, Dan Filato's fart box. You know, all the great punch, Dan Filato's fart box.
Dan Filato's fart box.
Dan Filato's fart box.
Do we have one of those? Play a Francesco. Pick a Francesco.
It's something I thought about, that's for sure. Mark in Manhasset. What's up, Mark?
Hey, Mike, how are you?
What's happening?
Hey, Mike, you should join Twitter and follow Artie Lang's Twitter account on Twitter.
Oh, God, the guy calls every day. You don't even hear it, but, I mean, he calls every day.
Mike, I hate to tell you.
I feel bad for the guy.
Mike, I hate to tell you, we do hear it.
Yeah.
We're hearing it. Play another one. That was a great one. Let's hear another Francis.
Guy's nuts. Larry and Tom's River, what's up, Larry?
Hey, Mike, I wanted to ask you how you feel about Dan Filato from the Artie Lang Show taking a baloney baton in a duty dumpster.
There's a guy who just waits and that's not getting on the air anyway, so just, you know, you waste your time. It's just wasting your time. You're going to be bolder to impress some other show somewhere. It's not going to get on the air. It's a waste of time.
You
can't get on the air. John in Jersey.
Francesa, by the way, not tweeting. He's happy about the show. Francesa's not upset that the show is ending.
Francesa's
very, he's thrilled. What was that? His baloney baton in the duty dump?
Taking a baloney baton in the duty dump.
All right, Rob. Well, that's brilliant stuff. Listen, I'll definitely see you down the road.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I'm going to keep torturing Francesa just in case.
Yeah, get stockpile some stuff up. And is that hot chick still with you?
Say that one more time.
Is the hot chick still with you?
Oh, yeah, yeah. She's very disappointed about the show, too.
Wow, that is...
She had to send you her love.
That poor girl, her family's got to be disappointed. I know, because you want to see... If you could put disappointed look in the dictionary, that phrase...
Wow.
Underneath it would be the parents of my fiance.
Wow.
They are... So I'm with you. I know the look. They are just... horrified.
My girlfriend's family came here on a raft for this.
Oh, well, that's pleasant. Thank you. I'm sure she's thankful. I'm sure they think it's so sweet that you bring that up. The father couldn't pitch?
At least they made it.
El Duque wasn't your father? All right, buddy. Thanks, Rod. Thanks for all the laughs, man.
Thank you, too. All right. Have a good night, and I look forward to seeing you down the road.
Okay, buddy. Take care.
You too.
Rod from Bayside.
Oh, man, that's better than sit-ups.
No, those are the Francesa ones. The best about the Francesa ones, the best about any phony phone call is if you get somebody on the radio or TV on the air doing a talk show, and then they rant afterwards about how much they hate you and give you that publicity you should.
Yeah.
Francesa's just makes him
a
bigger deal.
Right.
And, you know, the fact that Francesa has to say it doesn't get on the air when it's we have the tape.
Yeah. It exists. It's out there.
Mike, I hate to say this. It's getting on the air. Something's wrong. All right. Let's take another break. Back after this. I was recently looking to buy a car and thought to myself, there has to be a better way. It's such a stressful process. That's when my friend told me about a new way to buy a car. It's called TrueCar.com. So my friend told me that at TrueCar.com, you can actually see what others paid for the car you're looking for in your area. The site gives you total transparency and the confidence to know when you're getting a great price. Because at TrueCar.com, you get a savings certificate. And you just take your savings certificate to a TrueCar certified dealer so you don't need to worry about the hassle and anxiety of the old way to buy a car. And TrueCar users save an average of $3,000 off MSRP. So seriously, if you're ready to buy a car, why wouldn't you go to TrueCar.com? Negotiation-free guaranteed savings. A hassle-free experience. A TrueCar certified dealer that is committed to a new and better way to buy a car. Save time, save money, and never overpay. Visit TrueCar.com today. What just happened, John?
We had a standoff over there.
Who did?
With balls and projectiles.
What kind of balls?
Guns.
It was a good dart fight.
Yeah.
I got a feeling John Ritchie's not the guy to get in a competitive...
It was a good fight. Good firefight.
Yeah. It was a standoff. Josh had a gun on us. And and the camera. It was inventive concept. But I got him in the gut. With the football. Almost in the balls. Yeah.
Football's big.
I find that Josh is easier to strike with balls than anyone else in the studio.
Wow.
As you saw in the home run contest.
Well, listen, save your energy for when you have to throw out the director of Guitar Center Live in your room.
John, you want me to help you through? John,
I was the batter and he was the catcher.
Mike, what were you doing, Mike? You were involved in this too?
No, I was watching them kill each other over there. I loved it. It was good to see some blood.
I was going to say, don't get involved in something physical.
No. No, I armed Shane, actually. He was unarmed.
Arming people, yeah.
That's it. The last thing we need is you to die. And
I armed Shane up.
Don't we need to weigh Mike one last time to see if he's under three bills?
Let's do that now. That's a good time.
Oh, no. Okay.
Mike, are you ready?
And Mike,
also remember what we said. You need to strip down to make sure you make
it. No,
guys.
Make sure you make it.
I'm here on the right day.
Mike, I'm telling you, every last ounce counts.
Mike.
Come on, Mike.
Mike.
Come on.
Mike Buschetti, I brought singles.
On the Stern Show, I used to watch Carmen Electra get naked.
This is just like that, right, Artie?
Yeah.
Just like that.
Well, same breast size.
The body's very forgiving.
All right, Mike. So what were you last time, Mike? 304.
Is there like a drum roll or any?
Oh, we have some music.
This is television history right here.
He got all excited with taking off his hoodie that he almost crushed his lavalier mic.
Yeah, well, he's very excited when he's featured on the show.
Don't say crush when he's about to weigh himself, man.
What's small?
Take your watch off and not your shirt.
If you take your shoes off, you can
anything
take your
else?
Watch off.
Mike, how you want to go pee real quick?
How much could a $4 watch weigh, Mike?
All right, put your foot all the way on it.
He's on there. He stands like Ralph Cramden on there in this boxing stance.
What was he last time?
304.
He's 297.
Wow!
Yeah!
Yeah!
Wow!
All right.
Yes.
We have a winner.
Dude.
Dude, you're under 300. When's the last time you were under 300 pounds?
1986, I think.
Who was Reagan? So Reagan was president.
No.
Yes, Reagan was president. Just say yes. Reagan was president. Just say yes.
Put it this way. Cigarettes are still 80 cents a pack, probably.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
No, that's wonderful.
Hey, great job, Mike.
Got a while to go.
Mike, and in your time off, I want you to read some books and to change your mind about Al Capone being one of the greatest men of the 20th century.
Dan, that was a propaganda machine about him.
That's
what it was. He's misunderstood.
I watched a documentary about him the other night, actually.
Oh, good.
And it was saying that... he helped, they were trying to soften his image up in Chicago. He's
A
psychopath, for sure. I mean, they were saying he opened soup. Yeah, but you know what? Then to make himself look good and have the public not hate him.
I don't understand anything he just said.
The only show where you can get Mike Buschetti's view on Al Capone.
Then after the St. Valentine's Day Massacre, he was hated forever, so.
You think he was responsible for that?
But he didn't have anything to do with that. He was in Florida at the time.
Yeah, that's
sure
right.
He didn't have anything to do with it.
No. He was having, he was with the DA, Florida DA.
Exactly. Sure, he
perfect
had nothing
alibi
to do with it. He was with the Florida District Attorney, the Miami-Dade District Attorney. Right.
They actually showed Al Capone's house. I was like fascinated by it. I was watching it. I'm like, whoa, look at all this wealth.
Well,
that was awesome, man. Thanks.
Now, listen, Mike, I want to thank you really for your contribution on this show.
No, this is all, we were all together as one.
Thanks,
awesome.
Mike. Thank you very much. I'll let you say something at the very end. You know what? This might be the last time you're featured on the show. So what? Just say one thing. Just think of something that you would want to sign off as. This is your last feature thing. You might say something at the very end, but as your last featured part, what do you want to say to the country?
America, we love you, and thank God for you all listening to us.
That's what you came up with.
And
to say something witty. Try to say something that's like a quote that people will quote.
Well, I don't have that kind of...
Well, you're a comedian.
Well, yeah, but I mean, he's a well-known writer, but I'm not sure what he wrote.
How can you top that? Mm-hmm. Thank you, James. He's a well-known writer, but I'm not sure what he wrote. I mean, that's up there.
I can't believe I'm on the 300. I'm like, yes.
Yeah, you are. No, that's fantastic.
Still got a while to go.
Now, what is your goal weight?
Oh, Lord, I wish I could get back to my high school weight, but that's never going to happen.
No, it can happen, Mike.
John, that was 155 pounds.
Okay. It can't happen.
So that probably won't happen.
You were in high school when you were 31.
No, but I was in good shape at 17, 18 years old. Really understand. We understand.
Mike, when did you graduate high school, Mike? What year?
1980, John. It was supposed to be 1979, but I was recruited to stay an extra, you know.
Talked into it, were you?
Oh.
Yeah.
I had to go to summer school. I hate to say I had to go to summer school to graduate from high school myself. I failed gym in the ninth grade. That was the worst thing ever.
Yeah.
You want to see a collection of losers. The summer school gym class? Oh, my God. Trying to learn how to rotate properly in volleyball.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no.
We.
Yeah. We all got D's. We passed. We got them. Mother very proud of it. Well, so that's it, Mike. That's officially what you want the last thing you say to be.
It was a wonderful run, and I can't thank you guys enough.
We'll be back after this. The audience.
Though you may not drive a great big Cadillac, against the white wall, TV antennas in the back.
Thanks to the French Quarter's guest apartments for being our New York City hotel. Let them be your headquarters in New York City. Go to FrenchQuartersNY.com to book your next stay.
Welcome back to the Audio Line Show. Whoever put this Coca-Cola here is in trouble. My mother just texted me, is that a can of soda on your desk?
Uh-oh.
Right on top of the diabetes.
Who
no,
put
Mom,
that?
It's not mine. I don't know. I don't even care about it.
Yeah.
I could care less. Two and a half weeks without a soda or a piece of bread. What do I care? It's like they don't even exist.
That's nice.
You mastered it, Audie.
You think I'm thinking about it?
You took it out of your brain.
Winning, baby.
Yeah. I've developed three twitches.
Audie, you took it out of your brain, buddy. It's the thought process. It's gone.
Mars in Oregon, you're on the air.
Oh, I love you, Artie, man. How you doing?
What's up, buddy?
Oh, man, it sucks. I heard you guys are getting canceled. That's...
Wow.
Yeah, well, I remember where I was when Taxi got canceled. It's the same thing.
Hey, I got 7 years, man. Congrats to you, man.
No kidding. Look, you're a superhero to me, brother. That's amazing.
No. You were the first person I heard about talking about getting sober, so you're the hero to me, man. No kidding.
No kidding. Well, 7 years, so you heard me on Stern and you got sober.
Yeah, I heard you talk about it, and, you know, I could relate.
Oh, dude, I wish I did 7 years ago. I'd be a different man, but I appreciate it. Yeah, I'm glad for you.
Hey, and Buscetti, I mean, come on, there's no one like it on the radio. That guy's the best.
No one is like him. Mike, I hope you're listening to this.
I am.
How many people love you, Mike? Okay?
I feel overwhelmed.
I mean, you're going back to a life of obscurity and darkness.
Anonymity.
I'm going to be visiting museums with Chuck from Happy Days.
No, I got a feeling you're going to. I got a feeling you're going to get hired by somebody, my friend.
I don't know what's going to happen.
You love this guy, right?
Hey, I want to hear the Artie Lang and Mike Buscetti podcast as much as maybe Artie. You don't want to hear it, but man, it's. I haven't missed a show since you guys have been on. You know, I mean, it's. And even John Ritchie, as much as he picks on Buscetti, he's all right with me.
Oh, honestly, the Buscetti Artie podcast might be a hit, but I'd rather play the fat neighbor on a bad sitcom.
Me too. The Mike Buscetti Project.
What do you think of the name? Very original, the Mike Buscetti Project. No, somebody gave you a great name for it. Well, who gave him the name? What was the name, Josh?
Am I right or am I wrong?
Am I right or am I wrong? That's perfect.
I know.
Yeah, that's like your thing. You always say it.
Oh, God.
And Artie, that interview you did with the guy who did the Blues Brothers song, David Moore?
Oh, yeah.
Or Samuel Moore?
Sam Moore. Sam from Sam and Dave, yeah.
Hey, man, that was as cool can get. I mean, he was just sitting there talking to you and just being, like, super honest about heroin and addiction. And, man, that was good stuff.
Yeah, you know, I tell you, I don't know what your drug of choice was, as we say in the business, DOC.
It was alcohol.
Well, no, yeah, but heroin's one of those things. When people can be honest about it, they don't know how many people they help because it's such a dark thing, you know. And Sam was great. He was honest, and thank God he's still here and clean. That's one of the most talented guys ever.
You know, I mean, I'll tell you, I've always been scared of heroin. It was like the next step up. That's why I got clean. But alcohol,
good.
You know, did it for me.
Stay scared of it.
Hey, even the twins, you know, as much as, and, you know, I miss Nick DiPaolo. As much as I have the opposite views, that guy was awesome on the show, so.
Well, I'll say this. Nick is one of the funniest people who's ever lived. I'll say that about it, without question, Nick DiPaolo. So.
Could I hear John Ritchie maybe say one of those big words from Stanford or from Michigan?
Hey, say the one you said before the show. Didn't you use the word that we all?
Invectives.
No one even knew what word, what letter it started
wasn't
with.
Wasn't that a movie? Invictus, right?
Yeah, now you're thinking of Lethal Weapon.
No, I'm thinking, was that the rugby movie, Invictus?
I think it starts with an I.
What does invective mean?
Invective, it's like a harsh invective would be a scolding word, you know, like when Snoop Dogg came out and talked against Sterling.
We got to play that Sterling thing.
Yeah. They were full of a lot of vulgar invectives.
How did you learn English? English major at Stanford. Well, Mars, thanks for the call, man. Is that good enough for you, Invector?
Last thing, could I get John Ritchie to say football is big?
Football is big. Football is big.
I'm really originally from Brooklyn, so Artie, big up, man. I hope you stay clean, man.
Love you, Mars. You stay clean, too. Good luck, brother.
Right on, man. Right on.
Yeah. See you, bud.
Ala, can you say this? We have every major guest say this. Just say little people porn.
Little people porn.
Thank you. We have that on tape for no reason.
Unless you use it in the next 19 minutes and 13 seconds.
Oh, they baited you.
I think I'm good.
Probably won't happen.
They baited you.
I'm a cooperative sucker.
You want to hear Peter King from Sports Illustrated?
Let's hear it, man.
Little people porn.
Let's play. This is, we got the tape of Snoop Dogg. Snoop came out. Snoop, you know, listen, I met him
a couple. And his eloquent self.
Yeah, I met him a couple of times. He is just the coolest mother effer ever. Yeah. The guy's just smooth.
Yeah.
And we have a tape of him reacting to Donald Sterling's racist comments. Here's Snoop.
A message to the motherfucker that owned the Clippers. You bitch ass, redneck, white bread, chicken motherfucker. Your mama and everything connected to you, you racist piece of shit.
A lot of invectives.
Yeah.
But at least he didn't beat around the bush.
No. Snoop, how do you feel about Donald Sterling? That is just the great. You know what's good about that is you listen to all these pompous sports shows, Lupica writing articles. That's when the bottom line, that's what everybody wants to say.
Right.
I think what people want to see too is like Donald Sterling's car breakdown in a bad section of L.A.
I got a feeling it ain't going to be.
In the next couple of days.
It ain't going to be in a bad section. Well, Staples Center was kind of iffy.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's not in a great place. You know what I mean?
Tonight he went out to dinner in a restaurant, and when he came out to his car, there were people circling his car.
Well, that's when his wife stood up for him. Could you imagine his wife? What kind of denial is she in?
Right. She ain't letting go of that money train.
If you read the transcripts from 10 years ago from some of those court cases, she feels some of the same things he does.
Well, I'm not talking about the racist. I'm talking about the girl. The broad. Clearly he's with this girl.
No, he was with the wife tonight.
No, but I'm saying, right. Dan, the tape, I'm not talking about his comments. I'm talking about the fact that he's with a mistress, clearly.
Right, right.
The wife is suing the mistress.
That's awesome.
Like, wanting her to give back, like, a Ferrari.
This will be the greatest movie ever.
She said she embezzled money from him.
Mel Gibson playing Donald Sterling. That's perfect. Mel Gibson as Donald Sterling. Do I not? If he breaks down like some kid's trying to take his time. Listen, don't take my tires. I buy you clothes. Does someone else buy you clothes? No. Who else buys you clothes?
Who makes the game?
I do.
I make the game.
Do they make the game? Mm-hmm. They, and when I say they, I mean the blacks. Let me get this straight. When I'm saying they, I mean the blacks.
It's unbelievable. Unbelievable.
I give them houses.
Mm-hmm. That's the other thing, too.
Sounds like Jerry Lewis.
I love how he made that sentence where he talked about he gives them this, and who do you think gives them in this, and the cars.
Thanks,
and how
buddy.
He makes it sound like it's a one-way relationship. Like, well, he's getting nothing in return.
First of all, like, what
he
just
gives.
He's just giving it to him. You know, how many times did Chris Paul have to practice layups and run suicides to get to be that good?
That's my point. Yeah, he didn't give anybody anything. There's a contract that we signed. Yeah. His job is to pay the amount agreed on the paper. Our job is to perform to the best of our abilities. So
and they
do. It's not one-sided, my friend.
And
he's
they
not
do.
Given anybody anything. If anything, he's not paying any of them what they're really worth.
Yeah. Well, listen, man. From $12 million to $575 million.
Right.
Even when they sucked, he was doing he was doing well. But you're right. The collective bargaining, all that stuff. Other owners had to hate his guts.
Absolutely, because he's hurting their product. You remember, like about 7 years ago, Bill Roden, who writes for the New York Times, he wrote a book called The $40 Million Slaves.
Right.
And he was trying
Remember that?
He was trying to make the point that, yes, they're making $40 million a year, but they're still subservient to these people who are making 10, 20 times more. I think now that Sterling's opened his mouth, Bill Roden's book doesn't seem so far-fetched anymore, because now you're seeing that guys like Sterling, and there's more out there, I would imagine, he's not the only one, they really do see them as slaves, guys that they can indenture and use and not pay them proper compensation.
Look, the owner's got to hate this, because now they're opening up the books in a sense. Now if the Clippers are worth close to $600 million, what are the Lakers?
Right.
What are the Knicks worth?
Right.
The players, the agents,
Spurs,
agents have to be salivating now. Like, now we're going to really rape you.
Absolutely.
You
know? And they're going to ask for the salary cap to be raised, because there's more money out there to be shared.
Why not? This guy, I mean, think of the profit. That you can't even put a percentage on $12 to $575 million. And a team that's been good for 2 years.
What's the capital gains on that, man?
Yeah, exactly. But he finds a way to get around
it. Of course he will.
That's what they do.
Sterling's whole plantation mentality.
That's what it is, man.
Was, further affirmed by the fact that guys had to sue after they left.
Right.
To get what was owed.
What was owed to them. There was an assistant coach on the staff a couple years back who was technically, obviously, an employee covered by their medical insurance. He needed a cancer surgery to be done. Sterling wouldn't pay for it. The players got together and paid the assistant coach's medical tab. Otherwise, he was going to be scrambling. The guy may not have been here. It's cancer, my friend.
You know what else is crazy about the story? You'd like to think anyone who hires a black head coach is not racist.
Right.
You'd like to think they're enlightened. You know, everybody called the Celtics a racist organization. Look, who knows if they were in the 80s. I'm not saying anything about it, but they had a black coach in the 80s.
They did.
And that says
they had the first black coach.
To me, that says a lot.
Yeah.
You know?
I agree.
But clearly, that doesn't matter. That's what this says. It's like, he just looks at Doc Rivers as a piece of meat, too.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
You know?
And Calipari mentioned the story when he was getting interviewed by Sterling when he was considering the job. He said, and I'm not going to use the N-word, but you'll assume that that's at the end there. He goes, what is it about you that makes you think you can coach my ends?
Right.
Wow.
And, well, listen, that's insane.
Wow.
Why someone like that would
that's
go.
That's unbelievable.
Someone like that is in the business of basketball. It makes no sense.
Well, that's the disgusting hypocrisy of it all. You don't mind taking the money. You don't mind sleeping with your girlfriend who's a minority.
Right.
But when it gets too close and it starts to get on you, so to speak, then you don't want any part of it.
He seems pathetic in the whole tape because he's this young girl clearly using him. She might be, I don't know if this is true, maybe sleeping with players. You know, he alludes to that.
Right.
Behind his back, he's got this wife who seems pathetic. He's got a nasally voice. He sounds like Jerry Lewis in The Nutty Professor.
He kind of does.
Yeah, I mean, come on. I give them everything. I'm not a racist. You think I'm a racist, right?
Just don't bring him to the games.
Magic does Magic want to come? He can't come.
What's the word I'm looking for? But how karmic would it be if Magic turned around and wound up owning that team?
Yeah, it's very possible.
We're living in a time where Michael Jordan's owner, Magic's got a piece of the Dodgers.
Yeah, Magic's got enough money to buy it.
I'm not sure. We will find out what ruling comes down tomorrow from Silver, but I wonder if they have the power, if the NBA has the power to force him to sell.
The world is going to do it. Publicity.
Right.
Yeah, publicity is going to.
If it's in their constitution.
That machine is going to work against him.
I hope.
What's he going to do? Field a team of white supremacists? No one's going to play for him.
He can get a bunch Clive and Bundys. Maybe he's got offspring somewhere in Nevada that could hoop a little.
Here's the thing. Chris Rock has a great routine about the difference between being rich and being wealthy. Oprah's rich.
Right.
Bill Gates is wealthy.
Right.
If Bill Gates woke up one day with Oprah's money, he'd jump out the effing window. And the thing is, the bottom line is, unfortunately, there's not a lot of black people in this country, if any, who could afford that.
Absolutely.
To buy a team like
that.
To be the majority owner.
Right.
That's white people money.
Robert Johnson, the guy who used to own BET, he used to own the Charlotte team before Michael bought it.
Yeah.
But that's basically it. There's an Indian gentleman who just bought the Sacramento Kings.
Well, there's a lot of money over there.
He's a minority, right. But he's not... African-American.
No. That's still white people money, 600 mil.
Oh, no question.
We got to take a break. We'll be back with the last few minutes of the Artie Lang Show. I appreciate all you guys. Try to get to at least one or two more calls, but love you all. Back after this. Amazon is a proud sponsor of the Artie Lang podcast and offers a small percentage of your Amazon purchases to help support this program. In order to keep this program free, I kindly ask that you access my unique Amazon landing page prior to making any purchases online. The easiest way to access my Amazon page is by clicking on the Artie Lang landing page at podcastone.com. Click on the Amazon banner and save the URL as your go-to Amazon search page for future use. Every time you purchase anything from that saved URL, URL, a small percentage of your purchases comes back to produce this podcast. Now back to the show. Well, guys, this is it. Last 4 minutes of the Artie Lang Show.
Come on. Say it isn't so, Joe.
Let's try to get to at least one more call. Johnny and Callie. Johnny.
You know what? I think would I'd be remiss if we didn't thank Nick DiPaolo for setting all this up. You know what?
Yeah.
And thank
I agree.
Nick.
I agree wholeheartedly.
You know, I think he's kind of the pioneer here in some way.
And one of my top 10 best comedians of all time.
As and I'm a liberal and I agree with you. You know what?
That's saying a lot.
And I have it on good authority. That and I want to defend Donald Sterling a little bit.
Oh, please.
He watches 106 in Park every day with DeAndre Jordan at 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
Thank you.
DeAndre
Thank
Jordan's
you.
A host of that show? I did not know that.
Johnny defending
Do you know
Donald
they
Trump.
Actually filmed that show in our CBS Broadcast Center?
Well, no, I know. I've done a lot of things in
Have
that
you?
Studio.
Yeah, yeah. So
I
when,
just did that metal show.
When,
in
you can tell when, let's say, Snoop Dogg is on the show.
Right. Oh, okay.
Because
yeah.
there's a certain smell
Dude,
on
when
the
Snoop,
third floor.
Snoop Dogg came to the Stern Show. I'd walk by the green room,
yeah.
and I couldn't take
Get
a pee
contact,
test.
Right.
I'd take a pee test for the DMV. I couldn't do it.
I'm telling you.
Man, remember, and he got some stuff,
I remember
man.
Last year Snoop was on the show, and I remember thinking, these are the same hallways that Walter Cronkite mm-hmm. walked mm-hmm. under and Edward
gotten,
R. Murrow.
It's gotten so much more fun.
And now it's got a pot smell wafting.
Well, it's gotten so much more fun. Rob in Iowa. Rob.
Hey, Artie.
Yeah,
I
buddy.
I just to give you a good shout-out, man. I'm going to miss the show big time. I'm actually Facebook friends with Mike. I wanted to give him a shout-out, man. I'm proud of you, man, getting under 300.
Thank you, Rob. That is a big deal, Mike. And, Mike, listen, we're at the end. I love you so much. And I always said if I ever had my own talk show, you were going to be my Ed McMahon. And it happened.
It happened. Can I come over to you guys?
Yes, come on over, buddy.
Come on over here, man.
Hey, Artie, are you coming?
I work super hard.
Say it again.
Funny Bone at all?
What'd you say?
Are you coming to the Funny Bone anytime soon here in Des Moines?
I don't know. No plans right now, but keep an eye out. I got to do a lot of stand-up. I got to pay the bills, so look out for me.
I know it's not a huge venue, but, you know, I'd love to see you.
Well, I'll try to get there. If Mike can stop talking, I'll do the show. Thanks, brother. Thanks. Well, this is it, guys. The last minute.
Wow.
Mike, I love you, buddy.
I love you,
Thank
man.
You.
Thank you, buddy. It's been a great run.
Bichette's. You're going to have to keep me abreast of all your future endeavors, my man. Oh, man. Good to see you, brother. Thank you for everything.
Now,
thank you for everything.
Now, Mike, tomorrow when you call me and no one answers and you get the beeping, I'm sorry.
I'm going to be calling Dan up a lot, I think, next week. Really.
Dan, do not give Mike my number.
I don't look forward to, Dan.
No, I love Dan because I tell him to end this because we had a lot of battles, but he's a great friend, and I'm going to miss you, Dan.
I love you too, Mike.
Do you really think he's a great? Do you think he's a great friend?
He is a good person.
That's not what I show.
Much like Al Capone.
Yeah. Again, thank you, Mike.
No,
John,
thank you.
Thanks, buddy. This was fun, man. This was a blast. It really was.
It was.
You got
I'm
a great.
Sad.
I got
sad
to know your family.
You
got a great
You've
family.
You've been so generous to me, man.
Thank you.
You're a really good person.
Well, because you did a good job, man, and I appreciate it.
Well, thank you.
And I'm sure you got a great future, and I wish you nothing but the best. Ala, thanks for being
Artie,
on the
so
show,
much,
man.
Thank you so much, my friend. Thank you so much
for
everything.
You're a good man.
I want to echo what John said, your time, your generosity. the opportunity. Everybody here, thank you for what started as a phone-in to being now right. in the studio on a regular basis. I loved every minute of it.
Well, thank you. Guys, again, in the crew, thank you so much. Danny Filato, I love you. I love you, Nick, by the way, if you're listening. Nick, I love you more than anything. One of the best ever, and I miss you. And I'm going to end by saying this. Do not bring black people to my games.
You say little people porn.
Little people porn.